Good afternoon. Can everyone hear me? If not, I'll yell louder. That'll make sure that we penetrate every firewall in the place. That's a cybersecurity joke, anemic as it is. My name is J.B. Olson. I'm the Dean of Computer Science and Engineering here at the University of Denver. And I'd like to welcome all of you into our brand new building. We opened it for you. Actually, we opened it about a month and a half ago, but it's entirely new. It's the first time we've had the entire school under one roof, and it's also the first time that they haven't been in what I call mid-century modern digs, which means Quonset huts and other. I'm about 15 months into my role as dean. I come out of industry, so I come out of your world. The thing I did most recently prior to this was set up in Colorado an initiative called the Blackstone Entrepreneurs Network. We have about six cybersecurity firms in that. They're all private. I think the market cap for those firms collectively is well over $4 billion at this point. So that's just one marker of what you all know, which is that this is a category that's booming. We have here at the University of Denver, we've got a number of researchers working on various aspects of cybersecurity, including not just technical aspects. We've got folks over in the law school looking at some of the privacy and other policy implications. And again, as everyone knows, this is as much a policy set of issues, both nationally and internationally, as it is a set of organizational behavior issues, which is, I think, what the work we're going to be doing today, as it is a set of technology issues. It's all of the above. We launched a new master's in cybersecurity last year. It's a one-year master's. It doesn't require a technical background for folks who apply, which is fairly innovative. We've done it in tight conjunction with industry, and we price it at half price. So if you do the math, since it's 1 year instead of two and it's half price, it's a quarter price compared to what a normal master's would require. And the reason we did that, obviously, is that demand for professionals in that space is booming. But the supply of young folks who are looking to get into a category where they've got some real certainty that there's a career versus more generic degrees, the supply of folks who are looking for that kind of path is exploding as well. So we were very happy to launch that program this year with our first cohort in it this autumn. If you have interest in that, let us know, because we'd be happy to talk to you about that, either for your employees, for your company, or for, as is the case in my case, your kids. So let us know. Why are we here today? So again, many of you know this, but last year, 50% of organizations were lucky enough to discover a network breach on their own. More often than not, companies continue to learn about their breaches from outside sources, which is a fairly unpleasant way to learn about them. As I'm sure all of you have heard, there are the hacked and those who don't know that they've been hacked and no one else. And so learning how to respond appropriately and all the things that that implies is as much critical path towards success in cybersecurity as anything else. If you know you've been breached and you know you need help, regardless of your size or security experience, you're looking for the same answers. How quickly can you find and mitigate the damage? Can you stop the attackers and keep them from returning? Do I need to engage with the FBI? Should I retain legal counsel? Who do I contact when and where, both internally and externally? What are my obligations with respect to that contact domestically and internationally, state by state? All those differ, as you'll all discover as you go through the exercise today. The panelists today are going to answer these questions and more. They're going to take us through the entire IR process, including investigation, containment, remediation of a breach. They're going to stay here then and redo the entire cybersecurity infrastructure for DU this evening. So thank you very much for agreeing to do that. We appreciate that. But this is a great opportunity to do really critical work that is vital for all of your organizations, whatever it is that your organization is doing, whether you're in the industry or you're a recipient of the services that this industry provides. So with that, again, thank you very much for being here. It's great to have you. If you are interested in what we're doing in cybersecurity here, please do follow up with us. Or you can connect to us through the folks that set the program up for you. My office is right downstairs as well. And with that, I'd like to welcome Jerry Nguyen, Manager of Security Consulting Services at Mandiant, to introduce our panelists, et cetera. Thanks very much for being here, folks. Good to see you.
Good to see you, too. Awesome. Good morning, everybody. Sorry if I sound a little winded. I'm from LA, so I don't trust air I can't see. And it was a tough walk here. Like the dean was saying, You know, today we're going to cover a full-blown IR investigation at a very high level, not too technical. We will have some technical aspects into it here. Fantastic. Thank you, everybody. And with that, I'd like to introduce Steve, our lead for speaking.
Thank you, Jerry.
The next part.
Good to see
here.
You again.
Good to see you, Steve. Thanks.
It works right there. Which button? I need an SE up here. I'm Steve Sinadella. I'm the regional director for FireEye here in Colorado. I live in Boulder. And I want to thank you all for coming in today. I mean, and also, what a wonderful setting. I was down here a few weeks ago with my son looking at colleges. So you'd imagine just last night we did a supplementary essay for a college. It's been a lot of fun. It's a beautiful college. And thank you so much for the dean, if you're still here, for the introduction. And thank you for coming today. So, you know, at a high level, I'm going to talk just very briefly. They limited me to 5 minutes, which is challenging for me if you know me at all. Some people do. Long story short, it's about, you know, what is FireEye today? What are we bringing to the table, and why are we here today? You know, so, you know, FireEye is the only company out there that can combine not just technology, but expertise, as well as detailed intel that helps our customers protect themselves in a variety of ways. Proactively, and then of course, after the fact sometimes. You know, of these items, you know, you want to look at the technology we offer. It's a platform that really helps our customers not just detect and remediate, but also to stop issues that are occurring. And you know, as you look a little further down, you know, we combine that with, it's more than just technology. You know, it's constantly optimizing the solutions for our customers in their environment with a combination of things that are including the technology, the expertise from our IR specialists, our malware experts, and our folks that are out there creating intelligence in country across the globe. And you know, the combination of data, technology, intelligence allows our customers to have a vision that helps them make informed decisions about what's the next attack going to be and how am I going to handle it. And and that's, you know, really the gist of FireEye today. You know, that gist, that point is that, you know, we want to help our customers and their security staff, their on staff, make the best informed decisions. And, you know, it's a challenge a lot of times for some of our customers to create. I mean, we all know there's a limited number of folks. There's a career path here for all kinds of students at this school to get out and become security analysts and work in security at all the companies in Colorado and in the world, really. There's a shortage of those types of people. So it's a challenge sometimes for some of our customers to build a world-class team and maintain it at the level that is required today, whether you're, you know, MGM Studios, or GM, or a security contractor, you're gonna have folks needling their way, one way or the other, either smash and grab or cleverly into your environment. And the combination of, you know, we offer this intelligence for our customers to use, we offer also technology, but also, you know, to supplement in case you're having challenges keeping that team world class, we offer a managed service approach. So, let's see. I think that's pretty much that slide. Global, you know, we have a lot of folks in the space. FireEye offers the holistic approach we're talking about in a global setting. We have thousands of malware experts and security analysts across the globe, locally, in hot spots to find and dig out the latest threats that are being perpetrated on you. And to work to create an opportunity for you to predetermine, pre-know what you got to be ready for. And that's, you know, a big key for our whole solution. We have, the other thing I should say is we track about 16,000 threats all times. And then we can, with the knowledge of folks that go inside on site when they have an incursion, combined with this intelligence and the technology data we gather, we can help predict what you're going to have hitting you the next week. I would be remiss to say the key part of a lot of the intelligence we get is, you know, our life cycle of the Mandiant solutions. And, you know, the Mandiant team is, you know, from guys that parachute in when you don't know where the vector is and it's all going to heck in a handbasket, to the folks that are, you know, selecting different unknown threats and finding if they're going to be threatening to you and your business. We offer a life cycle, you know, are you at risk? If you are, what are you going to do about it? Or have you already been compromised and how do we fix it? And, you know, there's a whole theme of different proactive services that we offer, you know, compromise assessments, you know, remediation solutions, and then, you know, being proactive in tabletop exercises like this that are customized only for your business. So I think, you know, with that, I will say adieu. Thank you so much. And if you have any questions, please come up to me, and I've called folks on my team here, and really, thank you very much for making time today.
Hi, everyone. I'm Paul Carl Scott. I'm the head of the Baker and Hostetler class action team, and also am a member of the privacy team at Baker and Hostetler. Just wanted to introduce a few folks from our firm that are here that work locally on privacy matters. Our local lawyers are all litigators. We handle class actions. Hopefully you won't need our services, but in case you do, Casey Collignon, are you here? Can you raise your hand? Zach Demiola, is Zach? There's Zach, Sam Tillotson, and Zakima Henderson. So thanks to you all for coming. At Baker and Hostetler, we have a team of about 40 lawyers nationwide handling privacy matters, from incident response to counseling to litigation to regulatory defense. I'd like to hand it over to Ted to talk a little bit more about the practice. But before I do that, you all got a copy of this document. This is the Is Your Organization Compromise Ready? We've been calling it the Baker Report. Makes it sound really something secret. But it's a great resource. Ted's team puts this out every year. We're already working on the next version of this report, which will come out early next year. It covers all kinds of breach response and incident trends. Has a lot of helpful statistics to help you be compromise ready and to help you understand some of the details if you have an incident. So with that, Ted?
So very quickly before we jump in, things have changed a lot over the last 4 years, 5 years. Before, we really approached incident response with the using the Lockheed Martin kill chain, where you identified an incident, you shut it down, blocked the attackers, remediated, and moved on. Now we have to talk about being compromise ready, because by the time we even figure out that we have an incident, the attackers have been in, they've taken what they wanted, they've gone, and now it's up to the company to pick up the pieces and figure out what the heck happened and how they're going to respond. So you may look at a lot of companies and you say, oh God, they're doing an awful job going through incident response, but until you walk through their shoes and figure out how many unanswered questions there are and how many questions you need to answer for the consumers to instill confidence in them, you find that it's very challenging. So when we take a look at being compromise ready, we take a look at several factors, and that one of those is threat information sharing, which you mentioned earlier, understanding what trends are in place, how people are responding to these incidents, and what you need to be on the lookout for. What are we doing with personnel? Do we have enough personnel? And are we educating them and making them aware? It's not just new employee orientation and annual awareness training. It's what all those silly things that happen in between. So we laugh at posters and bathrooms and cafeterias that talk about compliance issues. Those go a long way, and regulators want to see that the companies have a culture of compliance and that they're making these issues top of mind. Are we looking for cyber insurance, and are we evaluating whether that cyber insurance is appropriate for us? How are we managing our vendors? We're giving them all sorts of sensitive information, but what's in our contracts to control how they use that information, how they destroy that information upon termination of the contract? Do we really know what they're handling? Are we giving them too much information? We need to take a careful look at that, because vendors really do cause a large portion of our incidents. And then understanding where our data is. I handle a lot of regulatory investigations, fortunately, not all of them result in a resolution agreement or a consent order, but those that do, the client walks in kicking and screaming, saying, we're being picked on, this is awful, we shouldn't be here. And then when they sit across from the regulator and the regulator says, you have no idea where your data is, the client walks out and said, you're absolutely right, We have no idea. Data's all over the place, and because we don't know where our data is, we can't identify vulnerabilities and secure those vulnerabilities. So we need to do a better job of that. And then doing incident response workshops and tabletop exercises. So we're practicing what we have in place with the incident response plan, making sure the team comes together and they're prepared. No one pulls out the plan during incident response. We don't say on the third day, oh my God, we should be on page 3, paragraph A, subparagraph 5. No one pulls it out of the drawer, but what you do when you go into incident response, you know that plan is there, you know the philosophy of the company in approaching incident response, and you know how the team is going to come together in a collaborative way. So these are all the things, whether you're a compliance person, or the privacy officer, or a CISO, or you're a CEO, these are the topics that we should be discussing. So that we know that our company is compromise ready, the best that we can be if an incident occurs.
I'm so glad we're on the same page on all that.
That's excellent.
All right, up next, Dan, with the introduction of some of the FBI's programs that we have.
Okay, these are just some of the computer intrusion law enforcement entities that are out there and working on these. I want to make specific emphasis on the bottom row there. CyWatch is a 24/7 operation. If you have an incident, you can call them, let them know what's going on, and their part of their responsibility is to start getting the appropriate law enforcement agencies out to assist and to start moving the ball forward as far as the investigation goes. Each of the 56 FBI field offices has a cyber task force that you can contact through the local field office. And the last one is the Internet Crime Complaint Center. That is an online complaint venue that allows you and others to input information about a computer intrusion or a computer incident, and then they take that information, throw it into the mix, see who else is reporting on the same type of incident, the same type of actors, the same IP address, what have you, and then they send out value added to the appropriate law enforcement agency to start addressing that issue.
Can I just add one point to this? Because I think this is such a huge issue right now with companies. They don't want to participate in threat information sharing groups because they're afraid that they're going to get outed. They're afraid that people are going to understand where they're vulnerable and they're going to be embarrassed. That's not what this is about. This is really about finding out what is going on and how we can protect our companies. You know, we saw a huge increase last year in W-2 phishing emails where people were purporting to be CEOs and going to payroll personnel within the company and getting them to send thousands and thousands of W-2 forms out. And we all say, how can someone be that stupid? But the reality is, when you get an email from your CEO, you want to respond, and you want to respond quickly. You know, we're in this generation now where we want everyone to hit our like button. We're on Instagram, we're on Facebook, and if someone doesn't hit our like button, we feel like we're a failure in life. And that is how people react when they get these emails, and these criminals know that. So if you can be involved in these, you don't have to talk about specific issues, but understanding what is happening to other companies, whether it's in your industry or not, is so important, because that is really what's going to protect your company. Indicators of compromise are not going to necessarily protect your company, because they have moved on, they've changed those indicators, and they've now tailored this attack to your company. So that's not what's going to be helpful. It's really finding out what the trends are and how you can tweak your internal education and awareness programs.
Fantastic. Thank you, Ted. All righty, so just gonna do a quick introduction of the roles that we're gonna be playing today. I'll be the moderator, and then we have our CISO, Rob Reck from Ping Identity, and the role Rob's gonna be playing is he's a brand new CISO to the company. Most CISOs in the world nowadays get dropped in basically into a hot LZ, so we're gonna actually act that one out. Should be a good time. Then Ted Kovis will be our counsel. Our incident response lead will be Mr. Eric Scales. We're going to be hammering Eric a big time with the typical questions that, as mandate consultants, what we get in the field, you know, whenever we're responding, there's a list of Hall of Fame questions that we always get. You know, they always mark and we keep track of how many times we get asked. And that's exactly what we're going to show here today as well. And then our law enforcement liaison will be Mr. Dan Lehman. He's going to be liaising for us to the FBI. funny story really quick. I watched Die Hard last night, the Live Free or Die Hard or something like that. And, well, the exact scenario. That's what we're going to work out today. Any moment now, Bruce Willis is going to crash through that window. All right, so the purpose of the exercise, you know, in all seriousness, it's we're going to walk everybody through, you know, a typical IR scenario, you know, something that you know, that Eric works on basically every day of his career. You know, that's, you know, the, why he looks the way he looks. We just pulled him out of the field, you know, not kidding. You know, we're going to focus mainly on, you know, the processes that, you know, a company or an IR team should go through. You know, not necessarily the technical details, but, you know, we want to walk through the process. You know, I'm a technician by trade, and, you know, in the more recent years, I've learned, you know, the process is, you know, sometimes a little bit more important than, I'm sorry, that hex value is incorrect. That doesn't mean anything to anybody most of the time. You know, so you want to go over the process, you know, a good playbook, you know, on how to respond to incidents when it hits the fan. You know, so a little bit about the background here. It's an $8 billion multinational company that's going to be compromised. You know, they make this widget that involves a CCTV. You know, cameras and software. They operate in 12 countries. They have roughly 2,000 servers, a mix of Active Directory, Windows, and Unix systems. Many are virtualized. Some are even cloud-based. You know, what's the cloud? You know, roughly 14,000 PCs. Show of hands, how familiar is this company? Got a couple of hands. Awesome. So we could all relate. All right, so game time. All right, so I want to keep this as interactive as possible, so I'll be asking the audience. You know, there might be door prizes, there might not be. I think I think Jessica has a 60-inch plasma screen TV hidden back there somewhere we could give away.
Yeah. Low grade though, so I wouldn't go near it. Yeah,
it's not 4K. We're not modern yet. But okay, so you know, our multi-billion-dollar company here, you know, operates, you know, fairly new. CISO just came in, and on his first day, you know, we'll call it a Thursday, 1807 UTC, you know, a security analyst notices an antivirus detected alert, you know, and it cleaned, keyword there is cleaned, this alert here called pwcrack-pwdump, blah, 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 on a server named server ABCXYZ. All right. This detect and clean happened during, you know, a weekly AV scan. Anybody still do weekly AV scans? Still a good practice, in all seriousness. Catch a low level, or it could indicate a bigger situation. You know, so, you know, lots of people are saying AV is dead. I personally don't believe that. You know, AV is there, you know, to help. You know, it helps detect things like this. You know, just low level hanging stuff. You know, a little bit of background on the server itself. It's a file server in the corporate network. It's a Windows system. Really, for the technicians of the house, if a Windows server is in your environment and it's part of the domain, what's its role typically? Or what does it have on there? Files, but shares. What's the one thing that it requires to run in a Windows domain? Domain credentials. Fantastic, sir. Let's see, what do we got here? You get an extra mug of some kind. Alrighty, so I'm just gonna stand here in case the computer breaks again, or I go flying off the handle. Eric, you know, looking at this alert from an incident handler's perspective, you know, what's this mean to people?
So the name itself is quite interesting because it's pwdump, which tells me it's some sort of piece of malware that does dumping of credentials or dumping of passwords. So it's not, you may get a lot of AV alerts for adware or for things like ZeusBot, those type of things, but this one tells me that something is dumping passwords, which gives me a bit of pause with this because you know, I could run it through our EyeSight intelligence and a lot of stuff would pop up. We see anywhere from nation-state sponsored groups down to
your normal script kiddies using tools like this to dump passwords. But if they're looking for passwords, then they're likely wanting to do something else within the environment.
So Rob, over to you. As the new CISO, you hear wind of this. You know, what do you do? Do you declare an incident? Do you kind of wait and see if for further details? What's your play here?
Yeah, so I'm a new CISO here, but I've been around a little bit. The first thing I assume is that the sysadmin somewhere installed this for some reason that made sense to him at the time. So I'd reach out to the system administrators group and try to understand, was this them? What were they doing? And do they have any idea what's going on before assuming necessarily that there's an incident here? That'd be probably my first step.
Yeah, and that's a great point. You know, when we respond to instances, you know, we see the knee-jerk reaction a lot. You know, as soon as alert hits, boom. You know, enact that awesome IR plan we developed 2 months ago. It's still fresh in everybody's mind. It's go time. When let's take a step back. You know, maybe it is the admin. All right, in this case, it isn't. Admin team replies like, wasn't us, don't know what's going on here.
Yeah, so we want to understand how this software got on there, if we could tell who signed in, when it was installed, was it run, was there any output? So any kind of forensics data around that software running. At this point, I would call this an incident, and I would spin up an incident response team. And this is, you know, one of the first things I think about when I spin up incident response team is, what are the stakeholders that need to be aware of this at this point? And I don't know for sure in this company quite how early we want to let the higher level executives know. Probably not quite yet. I want to have a little bit more information. But very early on, I want to be thinking about how do we make sure the right level executives know this is happening so they're not surprised later down the road if it turns into a bigger deal.
Right, yeah, all great points. You know, when we're in the heat of things, it's... You know, it takes one person to kind of take a step back, and this is for myself and Phil in the back. This is where me and him would just, you know, we would continue trying to figure out what's going on, but Eric Scales is going to be our guy. He's going to take a step back, be like, what's going on here? Let's interact with the right people. Keyword there is the right people. You know, start out low and then work our way up to say the CISO or the CEO of the company.
One more point I'd make is I want to make sure that the person who's organizing and allocating those resources is not doing the work. As I find, if the same person is doing both, they're really bad at both. They either get too into the details and they're not communicating regularly with the right stakeholders, or they get too far into communication and we're missing that technical work that we need them to do. I want to have two different individuals.
Did you have a discussion with my boss earlier?
I did not.
I'm just kidding.
I think the other thing is, if you're bringing together the incident response team, I think you're at least considering whether or not outside counsel is being called to determine whether or not, you know, one, do we really need to get involved now? Two, is this a time where we bring in outside resources and retain them under privilege? Have we seen other companies getting attacked this way? And is there something we can help streamline the investigation? Because sometimes we may have information because we've been involved in 10 or 12 incidents in the last 3 weeks that are very similar, and we may be able to help you figure out very quickly that it's not an issue. So I think that goes into the process as well.
And I think to add to that point, completely agree with you. When we get a call at Mandiant or at FireEye of an incident, the first thing that I do is I ask, is external counsel involved? Have you worked on an agreement with external counsel? If the answer is no, I advise the client to talk with internal counsel and see if they want and urge them to do that before they go any further with us. And the reason for that is we want to, in working a lot of these cases with external and internal counsel, protecting privilege and making sure that everything is set up at the beginning. So that is one thing that I always recommend to our clients. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't.
Even communicating with your executives, you're used to talking to them, you know the tone, but we can help you with the talking points on how to phrase it, because this is... You hope the company doesn't do incident response every day and they're not used to dealing with these issues, so you can sort of tee it up so that you don't instill panic in the leadership. That is the big thing. If panic starts, if there's panic in the beginning of the incident response, it's very, very difficult to bring everyone down and get them level set.
Absolutely. Hard to get the job done too, isn't it?
Yeah. Yes.
All righty, so Let's see, detective occurred last Thursday. It's 5 days now post that incident. A security analyst takes a deeper look because it was elevated to a level two incident based off of the admins not running this tool. So we want to take a deeper look into the system. Some logs get reviewed. Specifically web proxy and SIM logs get reviewed here for that server. And really nothing unusual was seen there. One of the next steps, especially for, yes, sir.
That's a great question.
That's a great question.
It's a really long time.
CISO, you want to take this one?
Why is 5 days gone by? That's how I ask.
That's a great question. And in our experience, it all depends on the maturity of the security team or, if the security team's always too busy or whatnot. It's only a level two incident out of four levels, so it hasn't been flagged as a highly critical right now. Just a few weeks ago, we were talking to an organization where they say things like this happen all the time. They don't even treat it as a level two, it was a level one. When the analyst gets time to do a review, then he'll do a review. So we internally chose 5 days as kind of the average of response that we've seen out there in the wild. Yeah, it's shocking. It's 2016. Yeah, this response time is actually very typical.
And 2 points to that, too. That's why I think having a scale that identifies the level of severity of the incident is so important. There's people who disagree with that, but I think with an incident response team who's not used to dealing with IT or IS issues, it helps them understand, am I going to have to work over the weekend? Do I have to pay attention to this after hours? Am I going to have to be ready for phone calls? Those types of things, it keeps everyone moving at the right speed, and everyone can sort of look at each other and say, okay, I agree this is a level two and not a level three. Where it gets really complicated is when you have this matrix where it takes you a half hour to figure out what level you're even at. Make it very simple. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, high, medium, low, whatever it may be, just to level set. And then the other issue is, when you talk about response times and 5 days passing, it's not uncommon, but we really do need to change that because we're finding that, in cyber attacks especially, the burden is on the IT and IS group to deal with this, and they get concerned about escalating issues and bringing in the incident response team because they're afraid that they're crying wolf and everyone's going to get angry with them and annoyed because it disrupts their day. We sort of have to get beyond that because when you look at some of these regulatory fines that are coming out, it's because the company has taken so long to respond because people sort of fumbled around and fiddled around and thought we can solve this on our own without involving other people. So we need to change our culture that way and involve people earlier so that they can ask questions and we make sure that we can ensure that we stay on the right track.
Yeah, my perspective is this 5 day gap, it's really 6 day gap, right? From Thursday to Wednesday. Is reflective that we didn't really stand up an incident response team to prioritize this. I said that last time, but this slide doesn't reflect it. We didn't effectively say that this is something that needs to be looked at immediately because those questions should have come same day, next day, not 6 days later.
Right. Yeah, so at this point, logs don't reveal anything. The next logical step would be to take a forensic image of the system to take a deeper dive into that. A lot of us here have heard that phrase, take a forensic image. Well, what does that really mean? Anybody want to take a guess on average how long it takes to forensically image a server? Right. So when we talk about live forensics, show of hands, just on average, who has the capability in-house? Awesome. We're moving forward. Yeah, so and that's a great point, with mature security teams, yes, live forensics should happen almost immediately. But once again, we're as practitioners and our experience that we've seen in the field, it's still a growing trend for companies to have live forensics capability in-house. There's tons of widgets out there you could buy. There's people you could technically buy to do it for you. But it's still an emerging capability for the industry right now. Ted or Eric, you guys are out in the field more. What are you guys' thoughts on having a live forensics capability in-house, and how often have you guys seen it?
I think it's great, But the first call I make, and this is where you really should be involving outside counsel, is I will call Mandiant and say, are you okay with them doing this? Because are we at risk for destroying evidence? Not necessarily for class action, but we may destroy logs or other artifacts that are gonna help us determine what happened. And if we do that, we're gonna be in a much worse situation. So I always consult with outside forensics to say, I'm confident that they can do this, but are we sure that this process is the right process to undertake?
And that's an excellent point in that, especially when you're doing it at scale, we have tools that, we eat our own dog food, so one of the things that we would do is deploy some of our tool sets to the client. However, there are certain things that you can only get from a forensic image. So if there are very important machines where we see a lot of data theft or what have you, we'll ask the client to take an image or we'll take an image for them. And we have run into cases, and I won't mention any names, but where clients have attempted to perform live forensics and may not have totally understood the technology and completely blew half of the forensic artifacts away. So when we got called in, half of it was gone for us to look. So things like app compat or on the file system getting erased.
And you think you feel awful going through an incident and not being and having an incident in the first place? Think about after destroying your evidence and you would have been able to rule out whether or not data was exfiltrated.
Oh.
It's a really bad day. So you want to make sure in the beginning that you take the right steps. The other thing that he's referring to is, if you're a retailer where you have many point of sale devices, we've seen clients go out and start doing images of thousands of devices. We may be able to use a tool like Mirror that goes out to different endpoints and collects data much more quickly. So there's a lot of efficiencies that can be built into the process by bringing people early on to make those decisions. You know, we brought in Mandiant in some investigations where we say, look, we're doing this for a while. We may need your help. Let's start getting the ball rolling. We may call you in. We may not call you in. Mandiant's not going to say, look, we're coming in. We want to take over. We're going to tell you how this is done. They're working for you, and they're going to help you through the process. And I think that's what people are most afraid of, that outside people are going to come in and take over. And if you're working with good people, that's not what they're doing. They're helping you get to the end game and helping you focus on the right questions.
So Paul, what's your question, Paul? But does it have to be a team, or is it a capability, right? I mean, not every capability is a team.
Yeah.
Sure, of course. You need probably more than one person who can do this, but I would assume they're not sitting there twiddling their thumbs in between incidents. You have plenty of work for them to do. Well, if you ask Mandiant, they're going to say you should outsource it, right?
It depends on the company, the size of the company. It depends on your budget and such. Of course, we think that every company should have a retainer with some sort of firm. So if there is an incident that you can't handle, you can bring somebody in. However, there are incidents that we think everybody should be able to handle on their own.
I'd say there's three C's for forensics. One is capability. Do I even have the skill set to undertake this? Two is credibility. Is someone going to believe me after I reach the, at the end of the day, are they going to believe my opinion? Or do I need someone to come in and validate it? And the next one is capacity. Do I even have enough bodies to do what needs to be done here? And I think if you use that basic analysis, you come to an answer very quickly of whether or not you can do things on your own or bring in outside resources.
Absolutely. And you can ask some of my folks in the audience here. There are some cases that we will turn down just because it's, I'll be quite frank, it's not interesting work that I can keep people hired for to do. And if they want to be involved in the interesting cases, the big cases, and really that's what we're here for, to help where you can't handle things internally.
And you know, when you talk about getting ready and getting retainers in place, or at least looking at MSAs, that's why it's important to talk to outside sources who deal with these incidents all the time. Because there may be a forensics company that you want to work with, and I can guarantee that every time they come in, their bill is going to be a minimum of $500,000. It doesn't matter what the incident is, they're going to charge at least $500,000. And knowing the vendors that you're going to be able to work with that are credible, that are really invested in helping you and not just lining their pockets with a lot of money, is critical in that decision-making process.
So having, totally agree, you need to have your agreements in place ahead of time, right? Mm-hmm. You shouldn't have, you know, wow, we just found out that we had this malware dropped. Let's go figure out who's out there. Let's not start Googling at that point. You need to have an MSA signed. You need to be ready to go. The balance and the really hard part is, you know, listening to the story of, hey, be careful. You don't want to destroy forensics data. You need to call in experts with, how many of these do we get per day, per week, per month, right? You can't call for outside people on every single antivirus triggering. Yep. So where's that line, and how do you make that decision? My guess is that's where most people are going to struggle. And if you're not ready to bring in outsiders, you need to get ready to do it. But at the same time, you need to get good at making the decision, where's the cutover.
And one more point before we move on, because I think it's important about bringing in outside resources. I've had calls on July 4th from a client who is having a major breach. And they say, we need forensics on site immediately. Are you going to be able to help us? I said, I can get Mandiant on site. But you're going to have to sign their MSA today. And you're going to have to give them an idea of what your network looks like. And they can't do either of those things. They sit there and they try to redline the agreement. They're negotiating it for weeks. And then after we negotiate the agreement, they say, yeah, we have a network diagram. We'll get that to you. And 2 weeks later, they still don't have that information. If you can line up some of that, you can cut off weeks off the time it takes to respond to an incident.
Yeah.
We had a question.
The person in the room that said depends on the system was exactly right. So it depends on, are we talking about if it's a VM, very easy. We just copy over some of the VM files. And if it's a bare metal system, depends on how large the disk is. Could be hours, could be days, depending on the size. Good question.
Right, so what you may think is the emergency may not actually be the emergency. We've had clients who have really messed up incident response because they think they're containing the incident, only to find that there's 18 back doors into their network, and they're in a much worse position. So that's the problem. The mentality is, oh my God, it's like, you know, I don't know, my wife, she likes to clean the house up before the house cleaner comes. It's like, I think it defeats the whole purpose. That's how people look at this. They're like, I gotta get these cleaned up because they're gonna think we're awful. Well, you know they're not gonna think, trust me, there's someone worse than you. We've seen a lot. So let the people come in, let them prioritize what needs to be done, and don't be afraid to bring outside resources in and bring the right ones in, because they're not going to tell you you're terrible. They're gonna say, this is how we need to deal with this situation. We're in the middle of a crisis, and this is what is needed to respond.
And one of the nice benefits of having external folks is you're gonna have, especially if you have a critical system that's you know, not available because of this incident, you're gonna have a lot of pressure to quickly get that, you know, fixed, quickly get the system back up, which may cause more problems. If IT is the one making the call, get it back online. If it's executives, generally get it back online is the story. And as a security person, you're the only one in the room saying, well, hold on, we need to understand first. That's a good time to bring in third party counsel to say, hey, hold on, here's some significant risk and why you guys should do it the right way. That's a really good time to get help.
And from a law enforcement perspective, if later on down the road there is a possibility of prosecuting somebody criminally or gathering intelligence from a nation state, we need an image, a forensic image of that system as soon as possible so that we can be able to say, this is what it looked like when it was discovered.
And you're gonna see, there's guidance that came out from the Federal Trade Commission recently that talks about bringing your systems offline while you can respond to an incident. That is the craziest thing I've ever heard. That you cannot afford to go out of business because you have an incident, right? There's things that you can do to help protect your consumers, to help protect your employees, to help protect the company, but you don't necessarily bring things down just because that's the most careful approach.
Exactly.
We have one question in the back there.
See if this is working. It is, okay. To follow up on a couple of these questions, if we want to have valid forensics image, and if we want to be able to do some intel gathering for maybe law enforcement in the future, is it a valid approach to null route the traffic to and from the host in order so that we won't affect anything at the host level? Fault and memory is still in place, but I've stopped a data exfiltration if that's my scenario.
And again, it depends on the scenario. Knowing that, so there's a couple of things. Knowing that any change you make or anything you have, you'll tip off attackers if you shut a back door down or null route the traffic. If you do see data exfiltration, though, that's really a business call. What I try to do is make our clients known of the ramifications of that. The attacker may go crazy and start compromising a lot of other machines, and as we heard a minute ago, there's likely to be more back doors out there. There may even be more data exfil that you haven't caught. However, if you do see data going out the door, you may want to stop that before it happens, just to see if you can stop the bleeding. So that's something I'll never get in your way of if you're seeing data exfil.
Right, but you know that when you go through this, you have mm-hmm. to recognize these attackers do have Plan B,
mm-hmm.
and B is bad. You do yep. not want that to happen because it is going to shut you down and it is going to embarrass you, and you're going to be in a very, very bad position.
Yep. And I'll give you. I know. We're sorry, Jerry's probably about to kill me, but I'll give one example of this, of where we did work with a client that we were seeing huge data exfil of source code. I mean, it was crazy. It lit up like nobody's business. They were pulling out terabytes of source code, and what we did was we worked with them. Because we knew that we didn't have this thing fully scoped. We were dealing with a nation state group out of China, and we didn't have time to scope it just yet, so we worked with them to set up some decoys and stop the bleeding. So we sort of tricked the attacker, if you will, put some old source code onto a machine, changed the names and changed some of the DNS routing, so that when they kept trying, and we watched them as well, they were pulling down old stuff and not the new stuff, and they changed it up. It was a pretty elaborate how I was very pleased with the client to make it look real, because the attacker was actually picking and choosing what they were pulling down. So there are mitigating factors, containment, that we can work with you on, or that you could do on your own as well, without tipping your hand.
Question in the back.
That wasn't really a question, just a statement. I'm hearing from the panel and the audience in general, the answer, the panel and most people are just, well, it depends, is the answer, right? It depends. And so in light of the it depends answer, I think what's highlighting for me in all of this is that the customer, the people are the first responders, right? We're at the first line, and we need to make sure we have the adequate training to know when are we helping versus hurting a potential future litigation or investigation, et cetera, right? So just kind of knowing that boundary of what we can and can't do, and then being able to formulate our incident response around that.
Yes, and that's a great point. From our experiences, Erica, correct me if I'm wrong here, when I first started incident response, I guess I should actually introduce like my background when I was doing introductions earlier. I started incident response in the Marine Corps back in 2003. Mine and Eric and Phil's boss, Marshall, we actually wrote the defense in depth doctrine for the Marine Corps. So we doing incident response for a long time, and it's not until recently where we see the trend of people having the mature capabilities in house to make that make that call of, when do we call in external resources? And one of the biggest things we've seen change in the last, I'm willing to bet the last 4 years, especially the last 4 years, is the level of training that's out there now. There's so many courses out there now, training, whereas, when I started in 2003, it was, hey, Jerry, here's a PCAP file. It's in ones and zeros. Have fun. Right, so yeah, that's a great point. I think with training now, the it depends answer, in-house, for me, because I've been doing this for a long time and I take a lot of instant responses to heart. The it depends, I'm hoping in-house, people can answer it more often now with the correct training that we're all receiving, and participating in events like this where we share ideas, sharing information with the FBI, with the government, they're the government, they're here to help. It's real now. I mean, Dan, I'm sorry, I'm going to pick on the organization here. You know, in 2003, we couldn't get anything from the FBI. You know, they would show up and be like, here's two IP addresses. Have fun. You know, and now we're sitting here with the FBI, you know, discussing real cases and stuff. So I think, you know, the it depends can be answered, you know, fairly quicker now. I just rambled on. I hope that made sense, Russ. Yes, sir.
I'm just kind of curious. I would like to kind of go back into the MO of what some of the hackers, you know, I mean, obviously money, things like that, but how? Where do they turn it into? Where do they turn this data into? And what's the data that's most, what are they going after, I guess, is kind of where, what I'd like to
hear. It's going to depend. It's going to depend. On who the actor is. If it's a nation state, even they have different motives. Are they after your R&D? Are they after, you know, economic espionage type stuff? Or are they after state secrets? Are they after source code? What have you? And literally, it depends. And the level of sophistication with them goes that if, especially with the state actors, if you start detecting it, they've been in there for a long time. They know what they want. And it's kind of at that point, you know, they've reconned your whole system. They know what they want. Okay, it's time to get the stuff and get out.
And that's a good point. I can't tell you. I think probably every client that I've had that's been involved with a nation state attack has said that this has to be an insider because they know far too much about our network. And no, it's the fact that these folks have a lot of time on their hands. And just as you said, they will spend so much time doing reconnaissance where they may know your network better than you do, honestly. And that's what they do. And they're in it for the long run. They're not in there to do a quick smash and grab. They're in there to stay there and to get whatever they need. They may get mission orders to, okay, today let's get source code. Tomorrow, hey, how about harvesting this information? So it runs like it's a well-oiled operation.
The attribution question may be the number one question that clients ask now in incident response. It was never the one before, but now everyone wants to know who did this and then what's their motivation. And it's good to ask, work with law enforcement on that, work with outside forensics like Mandiant, who's been through this, to understand what these attackers are looking for. But let me tell you, you know, before Eastern Europeans would hack into our clients' networks and they were looking for credit card data, and that's really what they're focusing on. Well, now the malware we're seeing that's coming out of Eastern Europe is querying for driver's license numbers and social security numbers, something we've never seen before. So the motivations are changing. We don't know why they're changing their approach. Are they selling this data to someone else? Are they going to monetize it on their own? It's really hard to figure that out. So, you know, even though that's an important question, it doesn't always solve your problem. And unfortunately, people expect a lot more answers at the end of the incident response, and a lot of times you can't get there.
How about with the simulation? In
the what?
Let's keep moving.
Let's
find out. Right now, we don't know yet. Mm-hmm. We're still working. But that's a great question. That's our top 10 in the Hall of Fame right there. So I'm gonna check mark that for one. It's like, what are they after? It's day six. Eric, what's taking so long?
Oh, we're already. What's taking so long? Only day six. Okay.
But you know, to further your question, who's heard the story or been a victim? Don't admit to being a victim, I guess, of, you know, the CEO email. CEO emails you, hey, transfer a gazillion dollars to this weird account. Trust me, it's legitimate, right? Dan, you know, a question for you. Like, when that happens and those funds actually go, where do they go, and like, how often are we catching those people? Can you answer?
Yeah, I can.
Loaded question.
It depends. No. If we can get the information within 24 to 48 hours of the money leaving, there's a really good chance that we can do a swift recall and you can get your money back. If it's past that, you're going to have to be in it for a long haul. I have a case that now where the They started taking it, on day, convinced a CFO to start wiring millions of dollars out on day one. And day seven, they, she finally decided that, well, maybe she ought to tell somebody about this. $65 million later. We were able to pull some of it back. We were able to freeze some of it. But what typically happens is the money is sent to one account, and then as soon as they possibly can, they start bouncing it all over the world. And then it becomes a follow the money thing, and sometimes we can get it back or at least freeze it, and other times we can't. But at that point, we use a four-prong approach that really involves the victim company as a couple of those prongs, but we found that four-prong approach has a better chance of working than just one or two of those.
When did you start seeing those CEO messages? Is that a fairly recent thing, or?
Primarily, from my perspective, within the last year or so.
I was going to say about a year, maybe a year and a half ago. So I'm glad you said that.
Yeah, and the W-2s, that Ted mentioned, those really ramped up.
This year, right?
This year, March, yeah. February and March of this year.
Yep, and we're going to come back again.
Yep.
This year, because so many companies fall for them, and the government's just honestly not doing enough to stop fraudulent tax returns from being filed. No offense.
The IRS.
You only have so many guns.
That's a different three-letter agency.
No affiliation.
It totally is. We're going to be back in the same spot.
Absolutely.
Yeah, my first one was January 2nd, 2015. Yeah, day after New Year's. Company was pretty broken up. They lost the entire quarter's revenue. Yeah, great way to start the year. Just quick side story. Then that one wasn't even a technical one. Somebody emailed, and then a follow-up call from the attorney mentioned in the email happened, and then wires just started happening.
And believe it or not, that's the one that's the most successful, rather than having them do something technical on your system or really get in and steal or spoof a domain.
And these are all because of phishing emails, and they're becoming much more targeted. They're watching us on LinkedIn. They're watching us on Twitter. They're watching us on Instagram, Facebook, anywhere we're out there, finding when we're traveling so they know enough information to go and target people to trick them into doing these things. I mean, it really is the way that they easy way to find out that they can get into either the network or get money or other valuable information from them. When you take a look at the statistics, the trickiest phishing emails trick 45% of the people who read them. The most easy to spot emails, phishing emails trick 3% of the people. So it still only takes one person. And when you take a look at the most basic email, a phishing email, I use the example of the Nigerian prince who sends out the email, right? But the DOJ still says that's it's the number one crime that's still ongoing that people fall for. And what happened with that email is, and this is in case you do live under a rock, this is the email that says, I'm a Nigerian prince, I want you to share in as part of the money that I have, and I want to put it through your bank account, and I will give you a large percentage. And people fall for it, and they end up losing a lot of money. Well, the email became so obvious to spot that they actually changed the way that they approached it. The response to that email was so overwhelming that they couldn't handle all of the responses. So they said, let's just trick the dumbest people and stick with that. And they went back to their original email. And I say, if you fall for this, you have no business owning a computer, because everyone should know that this is an issue. But it shows you that you're still vulnerable. Nope. I mean, it is highly intelligent people who are falling for this.
And I will be candid. I hope I don't offend anybody in the audience, but our red team, we take these same methods and use them to to in our red team to test clients' defenses, and we always go after HR with the phishing emails. Always, we get better results.
And that's probably because they want to be helpful. They're there to help people, and that's what they're doing. It's not because they're dumber or they're not paying attention. It's because they are in the business to support you and to help you with all of your questions. Mm-hmm. But FBI does phishing training. Yep. And people in the FBI fall for phishing emails, and they get fired for it. So, and I'm not saying you should go out and do what the FBI does and fire people, because you're not going to have anybody left in your workforce if you do that. But that is how big of a problem this is.
And they're gathering a lot of their intelligence right from your own website.
Awesome. So back to our incident here. So 6 days.
Meanwhile, back at
but
the ranch.
That was a great question, though. So yeah, I think we covered the motives and what happens to the data once it gets stolen. And that question doesn't get asked enough, in my opinion. So thank you for that question. It's always a great discussion point, especially since we have the government here. All right. So we're going to take a forensic image of the system. It's a physical system. It's several terabytes large. So the imaging begins on Friday. It runs through the weekend. It gets shipped to the security team on Monday, and it arrives on Tuesday. We begin analysis on Tuesday. So when we ship these types of information, what protection should we have for these types of shipments? Eric, what's your preferred method if somebody sends you, in this case, we'll call it best evidence?
So definitely encrypt the image and send the encryption key through a secure method that's obviously not in the same method as you're shipping the drive, so an out-of-bound method somewhat. But also ship it with a carrier for tracking the information. Make sure you got all the address information correct, but... I think the biggest thing is encrypting it and shipping it with tracking, so it's like a FedEx or something.
Awesome. So we're still day six. We received the image, do some preliminary forensics here, and we find that this A-admin account logged in just about 2 minutes before the AV detect happened. And domain admins or domain just normal domain administrators in the house, anybody? So Quasi's? What does A-dash typically mean to you? It's an administrative account. All right, so Eric, what can you tell us about these findings here?
Just like you said, I would check with the client to see what privileges this account does have, but this is a flag for me that it is an admin account. So this tells me that the attacker likely had access before they even ran the password dump tool, because in looking through the evidence, we see system profile service. That's not a normal service, especially the profiler.exe file that does not exist. That was likely the password dumper that the attacker installed as a service in order to get it to run under system privileges, dump the passwords to this info.dll file, and which they then deleted. So I believe that they've likely been in there already. They have access, and perhaps they're just doing their maintenance of keeping their password hashes up to date.
And Rob, earlier we said that it wasn't the admin team, so clearly this admin account may or may not have been compromised, leading towards being compromised at this point. As a CISO, how do you elevate? What things are you going to start doing at this point?
Well, now I really get the incident response team together. we want to make sure internal legal is aware of what's happening here, that we're starting to communicate that, hey, it looks like we had an incursion or someone inside our environment, and start thinking about what's the potential regulatory or notification requirements we might have as a result of that. So legal is the place I would go to do that. And then, raise the importance of this, right? Make this a tier one priority, or I guess four, the highest priority incident, and make sure that we have the right level of resources on this. And that's one of the reasons for including senior leadership on the communications. I want to make sure that the resources I need are made available for this. And then of course I would do some kind of a briefing to the higher levels of the organization to let them know there's an incident that's being worked on, and give them expectations around communication. Hey, you're going to hear back from us on this daily, or you know, whatever that frequency is that's comfortable for that leadership team. Let them know that they can expect to get an update at this time. And that way I don't get pinged every 20 minutes, hey, what's going on there? And we can actually do some work in the interim.
That's actually a great point that I've actually never thought of, was letting leadership know, hey, you're going to receive updates at this time before the investigation really gets underway. Eric, why is it taking so long? Every 30 minutes, Eric would get it from yes. somebody. Why is it taking so long? It's actually a great point, Rob. Yep. You said something there that kind of strikes me, notifying internal legal because of regulatory requirements
for them to start considering what are our regulatory requirements.
In the state of Colorado, when do you have to notify? I know in California, it's username and passwords. That's a threshold because we're California.
I mean, it's basically most of the state, and it's not where the state, I know we're going to talk about this later too, but it's not the state that the incident happens in. It's where if you have personal information on your servers and it relates to a person out of state, then that state law applies. So you have to take a look at all the various state laws to figure out where the trigger is. So right now, we're really focused on, you know, if it's a covered entity under HIPAA, do we have PHI, protected health information on the server? If it's not a covered entity, are we dealing with Social Security numbers, driver's license numbers, credit card information, bank account information, usernames and passwords, passport numbers, dates of birth in North Dakota, you know, things like that, whether or not we may have some regulatory obligations. So we're starting to focus on that and figure out, do we really need to be concerned about where they have access?
So to Ted's point, my perspective is it no longer really matters this particular state where you're doing business. It's and frankly, I know, you know, notification laws are basically state specific, but I don't think of them that way. I think of it as what are the most stringent requirements, and that's what we're going to hit. Because it doesn't make a ton of sense to do 50 different notification waves. You figure out what do we have to do, and we go achieve that.
So we're at this spot. We're telling the client, you need to focus on answering four basic questions. And it's not looking at, oh my God, is this Social Security numbers and getting to that level of detail. It's what happened, how did it happen, what are you doing to protect me, and what are you doing to stop this from happening in the future? It's that easy. And if you focus on those questions, you can get to the end of incident response and be in a much better position. Too many people are answering all of these questions that are really irrelevant, but if you really focus on those four basic issues, you're going to get to the answer of, do we have a notification obligation?
You got a question, statement?
I have a question that's maybe irrelevant. Can you all address the significance of the password hashes as opposed to passwords? Does that make any difference?
Excellent point. So with password hashes, the hash is just a different semblance of the password, so we don't see the actual password. However, the lines are blurred anymore. If you get password hashes, you can pretty much, it's really not much different anymore, because you can use tools for passing the hash to use hashes as passwords, or they're easily cracked using some sort of method you may have.
Here's an even more important point. So when you're on a forensics call and they're talking about salted and hashed passwords, mm-hmm. and they're talking about domains, the people who do not understand what that means either need to ask during that call, can you please tell me what that means? Or at the end of the call, have a list of questions and say, what the heck were they saying? Because I don't understand any of it. Too many people just let that call go on. They don't understand the real meaning. Mm-hmm. And we'll even, when we're working, and Mandy, it's excellent at this. We'll have pre-calls before we go on with the client, and we'll say, these are the questions I need you to answer. This is what I need you to say, you know, regarding the severity so that they understand it. But we're always going to ask them, what does that mean? And what impact does this have on the investigation? Because sometimes they're talking about a bunch of stuff that sounds horrible and has no impact on the investigation. It's just a bunch of interesting data points. And then at the end, we also say, when they tell us, this is what we're going to do next, we to level set with the incident response team, we say, how long is it going to take you to do that so that everyone understands when they're going to come back with information, And what are we going to achieve by doing that? Because, and now Mandiant does not do this, but there's other forensics companies who will tinker forever and ever and never get to an answer. And if they're not, you're not going to get to an answer, you don't want them spending weeks trying to go down that line. So it's a very legitimate question to ask, and people should not be embarrassed to ask those questions.
And that's an excellent point. In fact, just before this, I got off a call with a client where I was being asked questions of, okay, what did you see? Well, we saw the attacker stage data on a system, archive that data, and then 3 days later, we saw a command run for 4 days. And so the next question, did you see exfiltration of data? No, we have no proof that data was exfiltrated. And the external counsel asked, okay, what does that mean? What does that likely mean? I think that command was
understood what that meant.
Yeah, it was exfiltrating data. What? Yeah, no, he was trying to get me to get the client to understand. Yeah, yeah. So it was there are a lot of great questions and questions such as, but did you see any evidence that data was not exfiltrated? No.
Right. You shouldn't even be afraid to ask the question. We do this. We'll give you notice that we're going to do this. But we'll even be on a call and we'll say, if you're in front of a regulator and a regulator asks you, do you think it's more likely than not that they got what they wanted? How would you answer? Because you want to know that answer during incident response. You don't want to know after you made the decision not to notify, and now he's on the stand and the regulator's cross-examining him.
Yeah, I would not want to be in the room with you after that question if we didn't cover that first.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
I think it's just really worth pointing out. It's incredibly common not to know whether they got what they wanted, right? You get all these facts that, hey, they did this, they did this. Did they pull any data out? There's no evidence. You can never prove they didn't, right? You can't prove the negative. It's really hard to prove that they did a lot of times, too, and it becomes a judgment call, and that's a great time to lean on the external counsel to get their guidance, because that's not a decision you want to be on the hook for.
Right, because what they'll do, the client will come back to you and say, oh, counsel, are you telling us we have to prove the negative? No, that's not what I'm telling you. I'm telling you we have to gather enough evidence where we feel comfortable that something probably did not happen or something did happen. And it's looking at evidence like, are they packaging things up? Are they using tools that we don't usually use? Do we have logging in place? Or the reason we don't see exfiltration is because our logging stinks. Those are the kinds of questions you want to ask and make sure you understand while you're making the decision of how you're going to proceed. And that's why incident response has changed to the point now where we are being brought in as outside counsel, or Mandy is being brought in with outside counsel to present to the board to explain to them in the simplest terms why the heck we're doing all of this. So I think it's a great point.
Fantastic. Yes. Yeah, so 7 days, at this point, we're 7 days out. We get that infamous phone call. All right. So the FBI gives the company a call, lets them know that, they found a file that contains emails belonging to the three groups here, general counsel, director of R&D, and six specific engineers. All right. The email package is roughly 700 megs. How many emails do you guys think are in 700 megs worth of data? Years. And the FBI provides some additional indicators of compromise as well, to help with the investigation. And then they also want to schedule a follow-on meeting to discuss potential attribution. Dan, typically in a scenario like this, what type of information can you provide as far as attribution and the data itself? Do you hand over the 700 megs, or is it just a flat notification?
Typically, what I would do is, when I sit down with you, I'm going to tell you everything that I possibly can. And yes, that's going to probably include some stuff that I probably shouldn't tell you. But I think the information has to flow both ways. And if certainly you need to know what we found was taken out, and if, the 700 megs, I wouldn't have a problem giving that to you or giving you copies of anything else that we found that was exfiltrated. It's your data anyway, and it's going to help you potentially resolve the issue. Where it gets a little bit more tricky is going down the attribution route. And that's more from a, you know, we're in this to collect intelligence, but also to potentially criminally prosecute somebody. And by us telling you some of that information, you know, we think, you know, we see these factors, we see these factors consistently with this group, that starts tainting the victim's ability to come in and testify later on. So that's one of our concerns, but I wouldn't have a problem saying that what we're seeing here is kind of consistent with known MOs for this type of an organization, but certainly not saying that it is a specifically named organization. Is that kind of?
Yeah, that. I'm sorry?
Where did they find the file?
Good question.
They're not going to tell you.
No, we're working off of, assuming that we are working off of the image, the forensic image that you gave us a copy of, that's your data anyway. If we collected it through other technical means that are unrelated to your network, like a wiretap or a FISA or something like that, we have to be more careful about how and what we tell you.
Right. There's going to be a lot of unanswered questions when you're dealing with the FBI, and you just have to get over it. They can't share everything. I mean, you really do. And I tell clients, they'll say to me, you know, is this when we go to the FBI? And I always say, what is our goal in going to the FBI? Because, you know, you said it. You're in the business to catch the bad guy. We're not in the business to catch the bad guy. In fact, we really prefer maybe that you don't, because our name's going to be in the paper a couple years after this is all over and everyone's forgotten about it. But the reality is, we want to do the right thing. We want to be transparent. We want to work with you. But you have to understand what your goal is. If you want them to come in and save the day, they're not going to come in and save the day. If you want to show transparency and be a good citizen and help them with their investigation and maybe get some intelligence from them, maybe not, then that is the reason to go to the FBI, because there are some circumstances where you can come in and say, you really should be looking for this, or we think this is the motive of the attacker. Where I do get concerned is when the FBI comes in and they say, hey, we have this software we want to deploy on your network. It's going to gather some information for us so that we can better undertake our investigation. You know, it's up to you what you want to do. If we're involved, we typically ask the FBI, well, do you know what if it's going to destroy any evidence? Do you know what it's can you tell us exactly what it's going to be collecting? A lot of times they can't answer some of those questions. So what we'll do is go to Mandiant and we'll say, do you think it's prudent that we put this on here? And then many times they will say, look, we'll work with you in getting the information to the FBI. Let's try to hold off before deploying this, and we can still participate in the investigation without actually doing that. So it's just be careful about some of these things, because their intentions are good, but their motivations are different than your motivations, and there's a lot of things that you need to consider before agreeing to that.
So a little bit of a clarification. Do we call the FBI, or did the FBI call us here?
The FBI called you.
Yeah, so you found this file somewhere on the internet or wiretap or whatever things
exactly.
You do to find files. Okay.
Yeah.
In my experience, it really depends. And I know that sounds like that's all we say, but it really does. Sometimes we see it happen very quickly where phishing emails are coming out, or if it's credit card data, they're monetizing the credit card data very quickly. You know, other times we don't see it at all. So it really does depend on the situation. I always tell clients, if we don't see reports of fraudulent activity, that's good. It doesn't mean we're out of the woods. A lot of things can happen. So it's just, again, I think it's just another data point that you have that helps you figure out what direction you're going to end up going in.
Something else to keep in mind is that I know everybody thinks the FBI is going to go running to the media and say, right, ABC company, you know, was hacked and $65 million worth of data is gone or what have you. Like, that's not the case. Your company is a victim, and there are laws preventing us from further harming you, and that's certainly going to further harm you. From an investigative perspective, I don't want that information out there, because I want to keep that, keep the fact that we're doing this investigation and working with you quiet as long as we possibly can, because that gives us a better chance of catching the bad guys.
I'd like to add on to that. That's an excellent point. When you are shared indicators from the FBI or from another source, what have you, I know that our intentions are good, and hey, let's get the information out there so we can help everyone else. Keep quiet on that until the investigation is over, because as soon as that information is out in the public, it's useless. The attackers will stop using their command and control infrastructure that may be in there. They'll stop using certain types of malware that the FBI may have given you information on. As soon as that's public, it's useless. So do keep that close to the vest until everything's kosher with the investigation.
The other point is with the, I'm sorry.
The other thing is, you know, this is a relationship, just like between you and outside counsel or what have you. In like Rob said, if you can build that relationship before the incident, whether it's through, you know, contacting local FBI office or going to InfraGuard meetings or going to other professional organization meetings where we're attending, and you start building that relationship up, you know, first of all, when you have an incident, you call me up and I know who you are. Sometimes I can put a face to the name and what have you. And you've already got that build up.
And 2 points. One, you can waive privilege by giving information to FBI. So you need to think carefully about how you do that. And there are ways and mechanisms that you can use to help protect yourself and insulate the company. Number two is, if you think that you're going to get a law enforcement delay by going to the FBI and that is your only reason, you are sadly mistaken. As much as he wants to keep this quiet, it's very rare that the FBI is going to give you a written document that says you cannot go and make this public, because they are competing against regulators. They don't want anything to happen to become later to be blamed because they delayed the notification. So it is not necessarily going to happen. There are cases where they will want you to delay notification, and we work very closely with them in that process, making sure, because they don't usually come back and say, okay, now you can notify. They kind of forget about us, and we have to keep in contact with them saying, can we do it now? Can we do it now? Can we do it now? So just be careful with that. The law enforcement delays are not handed out like candy, like they were probably maybe 10 years ago.
All right, Rob, what do you do with this information?
So there's really two threads here. There's a technical thread, and then there's what I consider the bigger thread, like the business impact. This 700 megabyte thing out there is a massive risk to my company, right? What are in those emails? What's the potential? What's the potential PR hit to the company? So this is news from the FBI really changes the outlook of this investigation and means I need to get higher level folks more involved with what's going on. We're gonna get PR involved, we're gonna get marketing involved, we're gonna have, certainly the CEO is gonna know exactly what's happening here, and we'll talk about, we know this file's out there, and presumably the FBI won't tell me where they got it, but it's outside of our environment that it came from. That means that there's a decent chance that this is gonna get out at some point. Let's start figuring out what the implications of that. So there's a whole new kind of response process that's on the corporate side that would still be managed by the same incident response team at the highest level, but it's going to have a lot of work done by other people.
Yeah, that's a great answer. You know, the crisis PR side of it. Yeah, that's huge. You know, and like I said, we definitely see a lot of companies that aren't prepared for something like this to happen. Because let's face it, if something like this were to happen to any one of our companies, it's the worst day of our career. You know, poor Rob, 7 days into the job. right, but you know, a lot of companies don't have the plan to, you know, who do we call for crisis management, basically, and unfortunately, sadly, if most of the time when it's a cyber issue and it's a cyber crisis management, it falls on the CISO, right? And you know, like I said, the CISO is going to be the one that's controlling all the data points here and figuring out who do we talk to, you know, what can be released if we need to release say a press statement right now. And things like that. We had a question in the back there, the turquoise shirt. Oh, okay, fantastic. With that, let's take a quick 15-minute break. The panelists will be up here. We'll answer any questions. We'll pick on Eric Scales a little bit more.
Oh, why always me?
So it's been a great week so far. All right, so to quickly debrief the situation here really quick. So, during a cyber attack or intrusion, we want to make sure the scope is correct. At first it was just a single system, and for all intents and purposes right now, it's still a single system, right? But what do we find out about this single system, though? Password hashes, go ahead. Eric?
I agree, yes, you do. Yep, and some people have a hard time swallowing that. But yes, I would assume.
Yeah, and that's a great point. At this point, as security practitioners, yes, we could assume every one of those accounts are compromised. One of the things we recommend is if things are starting to get uncomfortable with communications, especially as security practitioners, start using out of band comps. Pro tip for business continuity planning: have a domain nobody really knows about until it's needed. I'm gonna give out my secrets here. If an earthquake hit in California, me and my wife, we have a subdomain that we use to communicate, and we just go over drills because I'm that guy. But that definitely applies in the business side of the house as well. That's one of the recommendations we make. It's fairly easy to start setting up a subdomain. Heck, just generic Gmail accounts to start communicating with. Eric, your experience with that kind of stuff.
I can't tell you how many invoices I get from Google and Microsoft for different. We'll set up a domain for you. We'll get an out-of-band comm set up, whatever you want to use, but something that is not tied to your network or your credentials, and that is a benign domain, so that if we are exchanging emails, an attacker does have access to your email, that they're not able to read those.
And this is a new issue. The first time it happened to me was, I think, February of 2015. We never really had this, and it's becoming increasingly bigger problem, and companies aren't prepared. They don't have the email system up. The thing you need to consider, if you are covered by HIPAA, you can't just go out and get any other email system. You need to make sure it's HIPAA compliant, and that takes time, so you should probably set that up before you have an incident. The other thing is, we see people using Gmail accounts and Hotmail accounts, things like that. It is a huge issue when it comes to collecting that information for e-discovery purposes when you're under a litigation hold or you have a class action that you're presented with. So we recommend using one consolidated system so that it's easier to collect all that information. People get really annoyed when you go to them and say, oh, by the way, I need to preserve your Hotmail account, and they have other things in there that they really don't want other people seeing, or a board member who's using out-of-band personal email account that they don't want someone to look at. You really should have that lined up.
Yep.
All righty. So, we've collected data relevant to the situation at hand as we know it. At this point, it's safe to say, or safe to assume rather, that we should start keeping everything. And what's everything entail? Me and Eric, we always tell clients, keep as much information as possible, and at the same time, keep your business running. That's key here. We're not here for you, recommending you to shut down your business, based off of password dumping. You got to keep your business going. So keeping pertinent information like the log files related to this one system. Not all logs. What one of a key differentiator there. So some people, when they hear you need to keep all logs, they turn on for example DNS logging and just keep that running. Right, the gentleman in the green is laughing. I'm pretty sure he's a domain admin of some kind on the Windows side. Yeah. Right, you turn on that logging, you're saying goodbye to your storage, like overnight. Right? And that causes all kinds of different problems as well. But keeping pertinent information that's related to the incident right now. And at this point, you've probably invoked your incident response plan, like Rob was saying earlier. It's go time. The people that need to be involved should be involved at this point. Once again, highlighting the do not use compromised system to communicate. We've had plenty of instances where, the domain admin, his account was his normal everyday account and his email address as well. Guess what he used to contact people with? Same email that may or may not have been monitored.
And if that's your text messaging, don't think text messaging can be the means that you're going to communicate. There's two problems: e-discovery collection, it's a pain in the neck to do it, and also, as casual as we are on email, text messages are embarrassing. We see, and I'm sorry we're picking on the IT and IS people, but the flaming emojis that we see in text messages that say, oh my God, I knew this was going to happen. I told you we were going to be attacked. We're owned. You know, it's just, it's horrible. So if you just stay away, because it's going to come out in litigation. It's not going to be protected. Everyone thinks it's privilege. Let's just stay away from the telephone. Put it down and pick up, walk down the hallway and talk to someone.
But Ted, how will I get my likes if I don't broadcast this?
The tweets, yeah.
All right, so day 12, roughly 2 weeks later, Eric and his team have been conducting, you know, their analysis, you know, going through the investigation, and so far they've identified 7 other servers, you know, and 12 PCs that have that profiler.exe malware on it. All right, so things have gotten pretty bad at this point, right? But, you know, as of right now, there's no indication of data theft. So at least we're not bleeding. When we're in instant response mode, you know, a lot of times, you know, we're just fighting that battle and we're not realizing, you know, there are some silver linings every once in a while. You know, when you're conducting a heavy technical deep dive of an instant response, you know, and the news comes out that, hey, so far no data theft, that's a good morning for us. I mean, Eric, maybe you could expand on that a little bit. But whenever the network analyst comes back to the engagement manager, like, hey, no data theft, continue with your investigation, that makes the day go by a lot easier.
Yeah.
All right, and even better news, no new indication of other malware. So right now it's just profiler.exe. All right, so Eric, at this point, you know, let's pretend we ship off profile.exe to the malware guys. You know, in an incident like this, you know, what would profile.exe typically be?
So in something like this, profiler.exe is typically the would be the dumper or the cred dumper or the back door. If it was found on 12 PCs and 7 other servers, it's likely as the back door, which maybe has some cred dumping stuff built into it. I would like to expound that it says we're 25% of the environment has been analyzed for this round of IOCs. Since we're at Tuesday and we've only hit 25%, I would plead with Rob to tell the privacy folks that your data is sitting in some hacker's basement in Russia, so it is okay to let us please install our agent so that we can move faster. At this point, so if we're at 25%, it's likely we're doing a lot of manual analysis and maybe taking a lot of forensic image, so it's time to install some technology or some software, whether it's in-house, whether it's the agent we use, whether it's somebody else's agent, something like that, to scale or to scan at scale.
So can you explain why it might take 6 days to go through 25%? What are we doing that's taking so long?
Yep, certainly.
It's not scaling, obviously.
Yeah, and in this case, that's a valid point. And we've seen, this is not the way I like to do things, but there are some firms out there, and also if we're not allowed to use some of the technology that we have, where you're imaging systems and doing a deep forensic analysis on each system, and that just, it takes so long to get the image, then go through the image, do the analysis, so say a couple of days per machine, and then you're siloed at a single machine at a time. You're essentially throwing bodies at it. Whereas if you can scan for indicators at scale and then just focus on the machines that matter, it goes much quicker.
Even if you're using your tool, mm-hmm. I mean, we find that a company who doesn't really understand all of their endpoints and how people connect to those endpoints, whether it's remotely. Whether or not if you really don't understand your endpoints, whether or not people are connecting to those endpoints regularly, if they're connecting remotely, mm-hmm. Whether we have to prod them to log in so that we can deploy your tool, I think that's another thing that really slows down. Also, we find that if people don't understand the nomenclature behind naming some of these endpoints, It gets very confusing. They don't understand what system they're operating on. They don't understand what they actually do, and that slows down the process as well.
That's an excellent point. There was a little story here that plays to that. We started the investigation July 1st, and on the 15th, we're seeing traffic on network sensors that looks extremely bad, going to internal IPs, and we kept asking the client, what are these IPs? We're not seeing these on any of the host-based inventory. We're not seeing any agents on these machines. I don't know. Well, come to find out, that was I called it the third circle of hell. That was where the attacker initially got access, and it was ripe with, they trounced it. And it wasn't until about the 15th, 16th day that we actually found it. And they got agents on the machines that allowed us to pull that data back, and we found the initial point of compromise, so.
And the other thing is, you could have stability issues because of the type of the processes that you run on your network. It's not because Mandiant's tool stinks. It's because it's your network, and you sort of have to work around those stability issues. So people freak out about that, and they turn to Mandiant, and they blame you for not being able to redeploy. And sometimes it takes a little bit of effort to make sure that it's deployed properly.
Yep.
Awesome. So once again, I want to make sure your question got answered.
We're talking about, 12,000 systems, something like that?
Yeah.
We're not manually going through 4,000 systems in a week, in 6 days. So there's something that we did in these 6 days that got through a quarter of it, but not the rest. So that's the part that I'm confused about, is how are we scaling that there and not scaling better? And this is the conversation we'd have, right? And it wouldn't take 6 days to have it. It would take 4 hours. And when you said I'm 1% of the way through, I'd say, well, what are you doing? And how do we get faster and better, and do we have centralized logging? The IOCs that we were given by the FBI, can't we look at that on a centralized place rather than going out to the endpoints themselves? Those are the questions I'd want to ask.
But that's because you're focused on the right issues. There's a lot of companies that struggle, and for a week they're coming back to us and they have excuse after excuse after excuse why we can't get more visibility into their endpoints, and they sort of just fiddle around. So I think you're asking the right questions and you're asking them quickly, but there's a lot of companies who aren't doing that.
Yeah, it's definitely a posturing issue. You know, Rob, you know, props to you for asking the questions right off the bat. For a lot of our customers, Eric, once again, keep me honest here, just tech deployment alone takes 2 weeks. Right, and we as investigators, we do our best to investigate as tech's being deployed. So if the first set goes out to 100 systems, we're going to take a look at those 100 systems, then just continue to scale up that way. I can't tell you how many awesome stories I have about an IT engineer or the deployment engineer, if you will, halfway through goes on vacation, and he's the only one that could deploy.
and it was kind of a flip comment, but I was honest earlier. We've got one going on now where we've been fighting with privacy for weeks on deploying some agents. They have an active attacker, a nation-state attacker, and we have no visibility into their environment because we send some telemetry data to our central data center, which. It's been through all this and that and the other, and we've just been fighting for weeks on trying to get that deployed, and nobody wants to deploy it, and it's kind of like, well, do we want to go after the problem, or are we going to talk about this for months and let it proliferate?
We're going to talk about it for months and let it proliferate.
Yeah, that's what's happening.
Yep. The deployment issues aside, there's always different barriers and whatnot, and it all depends on the tech that. that's available in-house, tech that's been bought, tech that's been a knee-jerk, reaction by, for this incident. one of the challenges we face, especially in a very typical scenario like this, is that once an incident is declared and, the incident response team has been put together, the plan is in place, now suddenly word gets out. Now everybody's an incident responder, right? Everybody starts running their own scripts. We have... local junior IT admin read about this cool tool on the internet. Now's the time to shine. All right, definitely see a lot of that. And it all plays into this delay. That's kind of why we played this scenario out the way we did, is just to have these types of discussion points of, why does it take so long? And the next question for Rob and Mandiant is, hey guys, when can we be done?
Well, we have I hope, you know, by now, now that I've been there 12 days, I've created an incident response process that's gonna tell us when we're done, right? And it's not gonna be done until we have, we've completely understood the implications of the breach. We understand the scope. We've done a communication. We have a lessons learned. So there's a lot of steps left. We're not anywhere near done, and we're certainly not done at 25% of the environment being scanned for bad stuff.
Yeah, that's a top five question, me and Eric get. You know, the first major update we provide, which is, you know, in this case, you know, this is our first major update to a client or to a CEO. So when are we going to be done? it's like, sir, we just started. All right, so to debrief really quick, you know, another reason why it would take this long would be, you know, the company didn't have, you know, a mature security posture. So when they're responding, it was basically ad hoc scripts, you know, running around with USB keys, plugging it in or whatnot. In 2007, we were guilty of that. I mean, that was instant response. You ran around with the USB keys and you collected data. You bring it back to your NS laptop and you conducted business that way. Three-letter government agency, we had to respond to, and we did that to about 1,000 systems. And poor Jerry, I was sitting there literally inputting this data into a central location by hand. Like there was no script at that time. And unfortunately, it's 2016, and we actually still run into that scenario where a company would just have, yeah, we have an instant response tool that somebody wrote a long time ago, and that's what people were using. It's kind of scary out there.
Andrew, what was that one we found? Investigate.bat? Was that our tool?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, so, you know, so we've covered 25% of the environment. You know, so say somehow we find a new indicative compromise. You know, how do we, for the lack of better terms, how do we resweep the environment, that 25% that we said were completed? You know, how do we go back and actually scan those systems for this new indicative compromise? You know, at this point, those scripts are starting to become mundane and irrelevant really fast. So, you know, we got to think about scaling, getting the right tools, the right technology in place, you know, prior to an incident. You know, like the whole planning process needs to happen at this point. You know, and, you know, Eric, as Mandiant, you know, top six question, how do we go faster? And I think you and Rob discussed that, you know, quite a fair bit in the last few minutes here, you know, where, you know, we just start figuring out ways to scale, you know, whether it's by product, getting in-house experts to create something to make it scale, you know, What's something you've seen? Let's be tool agnostic here. What's something you've seen that's worked, you know, fairly well as far as scaling to an environment like this?
I think Rob hit on it very well just a minute ago in a SIM. I can't tell you how it's having logs is great, but when you have all of those logs that are files and honestly you're using grep or what have you to look through those logs can take a lot of time. If you have a SIM, as Rob mentioned, where all the logs go into a central storage place, it's an enterprise-type database that you can search, then you can quickly search for new indicators of compromise through all of those logs and not have to wait a week for queries to complete. I think that's a big one. Anybody else have any other thoughts there?
Yeah, I mean, that either centralized logging in a, you know, Splunk or whatever your mm-hmm. SIM is, if you can search quickly across it, or any network traffic, looking at, if depending on what the IOC is, right? Either network traffic or SIM would be the places I'd look.
That's an excellent point. Yes, if you have
ports.
NetFlow or if you're doing full packet capture, what have you, network traffic is huge. When we don't have network visibility, I don't like that, but.
Takes Eric to a dark place when he doesn't have network logs.
Yeah.
Awesome. So we're day 16 now. It's a Saturday. You know, IR teams continue to work through. All right, another two servers and another 8 PCs. You know, so total compromise system count now at 29. You know, Eric, how often do we see a pattern like this where we just continue to find more and more systems that are infected by this piece of malware here?
Pretty much all the time. It's this is probably a good ratio given that we have like 12,000 systems or something. The attackers are not going to compromise every single system because especially if they're worth their soul in attacking, they're going to to try to be quiet so they're not, they don't get caught. But yeah, this is, I've gone up until the last week of, you know, getting to 95 or 90% of machines, and all of a sudden we find a new piece of malware or something out there. So this is quite common.
All right, so out of these 29 systems, the earliest evidence of compromise that we have found is on a PC named user123PC. All right, some triage analysis, live forensics, like gentleman in red mentioned earlier. So, you know, somebody did a quick triage live analysis of this system and found that there was a network connection established to that IP address there, you know, a piece of malware named setup.exe, and browser history indicating that acmenews.com was visited just before the creation of setup.exe. Anybody want to take a guess at what happened here?
Wile E. Coyote is responsible for it.
Yeah,
drive-by download?
Yeah, my gut instinct would be able to drive-by download. It could be coincidence. It could be a watering hole attack. Anybody familiar with the term watering hole? Oh, fantastic. Okay, so a watering hole. All right, so say I'm joeslumberyard.com, right? And I buy lumber from seattlepines.com, and so does a whole bunch of other people. So if an attacker wants to compromise a whole bunch of lumberyard companies, do they compromise each company individually, or do they compromise seattlepines.com? So they compromise seattlepines.com, and anybody that visits that website gets a piece of malware. So now an attacker that's trying to get into the lumber business is going to understand how everybody else does lumbering from Seattle. You know, make sense? Watering hole technique. Everybody likes to drink from the same watering hole. You get what you get. You know, so, you know, more recently, and probably within the last, I think, 4 years or so, you know, the watering hole technique has been pretty prevalent, especially in the defense contracting side of the house. You know, lots of the CDC's, you know, if you read some of the major reports out there, you know, you're gonna see, you know, that same pattern where they didn't compromise the actual CDC, they compromised somewhere else, fully knowing the CDC is gonna visit that website, that resource or whatnot on the internet and compromise them that way. All right, so quick debrief. So at this point, you know, I think after live analysis of user123PC, a deeper dive definitely is required. You know, lots of technical details that can be extrapolated from the system if we do a full forensic deep dive here. All right, so now that the IR team, you know, we've identified, you know, the attacker command and control, which is that IP address. You know, at this point, let's see here. What types of tools does everybody think we can, you know, have at our disposal to verify connections? You know, verify the IP address. You know, where else can it go to? Rob, I think you hit that a little bit with the you know, using the SIM. You know, but you know, what other tools, you know, do we have at our disposal here, you know, to search for this known bad IP address? You know, Eric, you know, what type of tools do you recommend, you know, out there? Let's not name names, let's name capabilities.
Yeah, so at a minimum, I would recommend something that would give you net flow data or data that shows you what IPs are communicating with one another and how much information is being passed between them. On the other end, it's always best. I like full packet capture, so that if you do identify something like this, not only would you be able to see who's talking with one another, but then you could go back in time to see what are they talking about, and look at those packet captures, depending on the time.
So it depends on the environment, right? If you're a traditional perimeter network, you use firewall logs, DNS mm-hmm. logs, tell you who was looking for that website and mm-hmm. who went there. If you have a lot of remote workers and you don't have visibility into that, or you have split tunneling, so they're not going back in through your corporate network, it's going to be more challenging. You have to understand what are your optics on those endpoints. What kind of control do you have? So it depends, right? It always depends.
Do you think that's a key question also when you're vetting forensics firms before you're even in incident response, is figuring out what their endpoint monitoring can do and whether it can look back in time or if it's only forward looking? Because you lose so much of the picture after spending all this time deploying these tools and not being able to figure out what happened maybe before where you are.
Oh, absolutely. And if they even have the capability to do that.
Right.
So, you know, if you don't, do they, But yes, time and time again, it's been, it always happens this way where you'll notice, you know, 5 or 6 days in, and you're like, oh, wait, that is what was going on. And then you have to go back 5 days and look at everything again and put everything together that you may not have known the attacker was coming in this way, but then something tipped you off to it 5 days later. All of a sudden, you've got the full picture. But can you go back and take a look at it?
And that's why sometimes, and yes, all endpoint monitoring is not created equally, and I think you really need to ask the right questions, but that's why sometimes if Mandiant is brought in a payment card incident as a PFI, a PCI DSS forensics investigator, they will want to deploy their own tool because the forensics company that initially started does not have the capability of looking back in time.
Rob,
it's not because they want to make more money. Yeah. It's because they need to have more visibility into it.
That's exactly right, yes.
Rob, so a question not in our playbook, but you know, since you're a new CISO to the company, let me ask you this. Barring any budget issues, what would be your dream scenario for a network setup?
I'd say, you know, you guys, this is spur of the moment for me, guys. The biggest thing I'd say is the perimeter isn't all that an effective way to stopping bad guys anymore. And I really believe in putting defenses closer to the resources you're trying to protect, which includes the endpoints. So the laptop servers, whatever it is that the users or the resources are on, and then the data that you're trying to protect, which can be the applications or the data itself. We look at things like I don't know how much we talk about vendors, but you know, endpoint protection tools, application whitelisting, next generation detection of heuristics and those types of things on the endpoint, having control there, having strong authentication. I believe that maybe the most important thing we do is get two-factor authentication in an environment now, and that's the only way you can get access, and that can be, doesn't have to be a tool that, you know, like Ping makes, like a two-factor auth. It could also be certificates installed on those devices. There's lots of ways to get strong authentication, but I think it's critical that we get that. And then for the resources themselves, making sure that only the right folks can get to it with a strong access control policy that's well understood. So that's way more important than saying I got this really good firewall at the end that has all the logging in the world. I'd much rather see that distributed that model that has logging back to a central place where we can get all the visibility we need.
And you know what, now, and there's a dead on, because now regulators know what to ask for, because they're seeing companies after an incident, they're asking, what are you doing to remediate? And they're listing those things to help themselves be better positioned the next time they're attacked. So regulators are asking, are you deploying this? Why weren't you using this before? So they're going to ask these questions. So if you're not doing this now, you really need to seriously consider.
And two-factor authentication, right? I just said a bunch of different stuff. It's all great. There's a lot of work to get there. But two-factor auth, if you guys aren't doing it, just go do it. Figure out a way to get two-factor authentication in place. People steal passwords. That's what they do.
Right.
This password hash that got dumped on the internet probably got dumped on the internet. That's not nearly as big an impact if you had to do a second factor in order to get access to the accounts.
And we're still seeing people not use two-factor on Outlook web access.
Right.
They're not using it on Lawson. If you can remotely get into your Lawson portal for HR needs, whether it's for benefits or direct deposit, make sure that you're using two-factor authentication. I mean, it's really simple to address some of these issues and prevent some of these attacks.
Yeah. And heck, we're still not seeing folks not use it on VPN.
Right.
So if you aren't, please, just as you said, it is. It's if you look through this, it all goes back to the authentication the problem.
Right.
And it's, we've got passwords, and that's how we got access.
And there are, and I'm sorry, this is such an important point, though. There, you'll hear resistance to two-factor because of usability issues. People don't want to have to do a second thing, and I get that. I think there's an argument to be made both ways, but you can do two-factor that's not painful, and doing certificates on machines that you control is painless to the user. It may be a little painful for IT to manage, but the users, they have no negative impact, right? They now we know that the machine that they're connecting from is a trusted machine that we provision a certificate to. That's one factor. Their username and password's another factor, and you get that level of control that the guy in Russia can't log in with your username and password without having to inconvenience your users. So don't give up just because maybe, hey, my company wouldn't be willing to take that kind of a measure.
Yeah, great point. Two-factor. I mean, that's the way to go. Gmail account users, do you guys have two-factor enabled? Probably should. Pro tip.
Google Authenticator.
Yeah. Great tool. Everything is free, so it's a great tool. All right, so back to our scenario here. Thank you for that, Rob. Kind of wanted to throw out some good security infrastructure pro tips there. So Eric's team does a deeper dive of user 123 PC. You know, so they identified 3 days after setup.exe was ran and installed on the system that there was evidence of browsing file shares, specifically one HR share that held completed W-2s. Sound familiar yet? Eric also identifies evidence of a zip archive being created. However, the attacker secure deleted that archive. All right, so we only have metadata, you know, showing that this archive existed. Right, network traffic analysis shows that five systems are actively beaconing to that IP address. You know, there's no talkback though, so these five systems are just sitting on the network somewhere, beaconing out. You know, so we have evidence of a zip archive created, right? History of browsing HR for completed W-2s. Big question here is, who thinks this data wasn't stolen? That was not stolen.
Can I ask you a question about these five systems? Mm-hmm. Are those five systems a subset of the 29 systems that we had malware on, or is this five new systems?
It's a subset of those. So, Eric, what are your thoughts on whether or not things are stolen or not?
Yes.
Care to elaborate?
Well, it's I think you put it a good way one time, and I can't remember how you exactly put it, but you know, it's as if you've put on your clothes, you're getting in the car.
Not my example.
I know, but I'm trying to do it here. You're going to work, but somebody says, "Well, did you actually go to work?" I don't know. There wasn't a badge reader on the door. Did he go to, you know? But somebody saw you get in your car. They saw you drive to work. They saw you show up in the parking lot, and walk up to the front door. So, if they're going to go through all this trouble to, go ahead.
What if we took out the attacker secure deleted the archive? Would that change your opinion?
We could look at the archive then, right?
Well, that is a good question. So. And I love it because I would, let me preface all this with, I would never state that yes, this happened, because I don't have conclusive proof. Yeah. I don't have conclusive proof. To me, proof that data was exfiltrated is if I have a packet capture of the data actually going out to an attacker's IP address, and that packet capture contains a full intact archive that is not corrupted, that can be opened. If it was not deleted, that is a good point. That may tell me that, hey, maybe the attacker's malware crashed at some point and didn't, because usually they clean up after themselves. After they transmit, it deletes it. So that is a possible indicator that maybe it didn't get transmitted. But I'd still kind of err on that side.
I agree, but I think these are the questions you need, mm-hmm, to push back on and say, does this push us over the line? Or do we feel, are we being too conservative here? Or do we really think that we have an issue? And, yep, and remember, these are consumer fraud statutes that we're dealing with, so you err on the side of the consumer. There's no doubt about that. But we also don't want to alarm consumers unnecessarily. They get a lot, there's breach fatigue going on, they're getting a lot of notices in the mail. People panic when they get these letters. Some people throw them away. We want them to go to people when they really need to go to people so that they can protect themselves. So you just need to step back and make sure. The other reason you go through this is not because you're questioning Mandiant on whether or not they're doing appropriate analysis. You want, at the end of the day, for everybody that was involved, the board, incident response team, any stakeholders set to say, we made the right decision. We're never going to know for 100% certainty that we should do this, but you know what? We made the right decision. You don't want to go back and say, should have asked him that question. Ask that question, find out what his temperature is, how he feels about it, and it'll make things go smoothly.
Yep. So, your thoughts on whether or not data was stolen?
Yeah, you know what I would say, very most likely data was stolen, and that's the way I tell the story. And my expectation is at a company that you've been at for a little while, you should understand your leadership team well enough to know, are they going to do the right thing, or are they looking for ways to skate around things? And hopefully you don't work at a company that's looking for ways to skate around doing the right thing, but you need to know that, right? And I think that changes the way you present and the way you talk about it. I kind of take for granted that my leadership would say, yeah, the right thing to do is to let people know that their stuff was probably stolen. There are probably organizations where you need to think about this differently, and you need to understand those leaders' motivations.
And I characterize it a little bit differently. I think I hate the term "get me out of this notification" or "get me out of this." I don't like that. We're not getting you out of anything. We're figuring out what happened and what the appropriate way to respond. I think each company has a different risk appetite, and you have to understand what that appetite is. And it may be because the information you hold is not as sensitive. It may be for a variety of reasons. But understanding that risk appetite and responding that way is appropriate for that organization.
So for legal and CISO here. Oh.
So now you sound like you're from the Department of Health and Human Services, because they believe that anytime someone has potentially access to something,
that was actually going to be my question. So I'm glad he asked it.
It's a notifiable event. Well, my whole thing would be, you know, was there command and control access? What could they actually do? Was this automated? You know, was this a spray and pray type of situation where we're shooting out malware, hoping we get something, but we actually can't access that information? A human being cannot access it until it's exfiltrated from the network. Those are the questions we're asking. Just because a file can be automatically accessed does not mean, in my opinion, that a breach notification law has been triggered.
And that's actually a good question, because I did have a case like this where we were specifically asked, did the attacker just lump these up, or did they open them up? And so we went through some excruciating detail of evidence and shell bags and user assist to see if, you know, it was the attacker really opening these up, and no, they weren't. But
And where this comes into, this really is important for everyone with ransomware, because so many people are notifying on ransomware when we don't need to, and or they're not documenting carefully why they believe you don't need to notify. So I think, you know, this is going to be increasingly important. There's projections that next year, I think Beasley, who is a leading carrier in cyber insurance, is predicting that next year ransomware attacks are going to increase 6 times what they were this year. So, I mean, that is huge.
Didn't HHS say that ransomware does require notification for HIP?
Depends on if you read their press release or you read their guidance. I think anyone who reads their press release would walk away and say, oh my God, we have to notify every time we have ransomware. If you read their guidance is nothing, there's nothing changed. What they say is that when you have ransomware, you probably have a breach, but you can still go through the 4-factor test under HIPAA and document why you think there's a low probability of a compromise. Hmm. And if you go through that analysis and document, I would say in most situations, you're going to be able to show that it was either commodity ransomware or they didn't have the capability to access that information. So that's what people are thinking, but I think that's the wrong conclusion when reading their guidance.
That's a good perspective.
That's a great legal answer.
Yeah, it is. It depends.
Can we just say it's encrypted, therefore nobody can read it anyway?
It's encrypted now, yeah, thank you.
For Dan, you know, speaking of, you know, we kind of focused on this earlier, you know, talking about, you know, transparency between, you know, a victim and law enforcement. You know, so say, you know, this company is very transparent. They give you, you know, the IP address, you know, that these systems are beaconing out to. You know, typically, what can you return? What information can you provide to a victim if they provide information like this?
So at this point, we've got a hot trail to start following, and where you may not be able to identify who owns that IP address or what happens to that IP address afterwards, we can. And we may not be able to tell you, you know, John Smith or company ABC as the web, as that IP address, but we can probably tell you, okay, it's a company that deals in this. And that, I would assume, is going to have a big impact on what you do from there and what it's going to go to start showing motivation.
Awesome. Thank you, Dan. All right. And so quick debrief. I think we've hammered home notifications enough already. Any additional thoughts on notification, Ted?
No, I you know, the law's changing every day. Leave it to the lawyer, outside lawyers who are experienced in this area to figure it out. We have too many clients who are going through trying to figure out what each law says. We deal with this every day. It's very simple for us to sort of figure out how we're going to approach this and make a recommendation. So don't struggle with the laws as much. Really rely heavily on outside counsel.
I have a client who suffered a breach recently, and while they notified us to let us know of the breach and for us to notify their carrier, their first instinct was, oh my God, we need to let everybody know now. And so they did. They send out an email to all of their employees saying, we've had a data breach.
Right.
You could have been affected. Does that change? I mean, obviously they still have to follow compliance laws for notification, but does that change any of their liability in admitting the breach or anything like that?
What it does, so when you refer to very transparent, I call that being stupid. and going out with a communication when you're not prepared to talk about what happened, how did it happen, what are you doing to protect me, what are you doing to stop this from happening, falls in the that's a stupid step. So I think going out and reacting that way is going to put you in a much worse position. It's not about legal liability as far as you're admitting to something. It's about, I don't have the resources in place to help these people and answer their questions, and they're gonna be angry at me, and now they're gonna complain to regulators, they're gonna file lawsuits, and it's gonna be a big mess. So we sort of said, get everything together. And the W-2 emails were a big example there, where we call clients, they say, we're sending out an email to our entire workforce today telling them their Social Security numbers have been stolen and they should put the IRS on alert so that no fraudulent tax returns. Well, that's stupid. We don't even know who's impacted. Give us 2 days. We will get you something for your intranet site. We will give you the email communication. We will do the reporting to the regulators. We'll talk to the IRS. We'll deal with Minnesota because they're acting as the state, multi-state, of getting notifying other states that there may be fraudulent tax returns. And we could do that all at once. So we notify people. Employees go, wow, this really stinks. But you guys have done a heck of a lot in the last 48 hours to protect me, and I appreciate that. So I think it really is, your first communication isn't about winning back customers or winning back employees. It's about instilling confidence in them that you've approached this the right way.
There's one thing to hit on your point that I would have talked about earlier in this incident is the creation of a hold statement or a holding statement.
Yep.
With basically the idea that we're not going to go out and issue a press release right now saying we were breached, but we should write something so we're prepared to respond if it gets out some other way.
Right.
And we should have one sheet of music that we're all singing from that's, you know, created probably by our PR team with the CISO and the CEOs. Yeah, this is the story that we're comfortable with. And get that to the right hands. Not everyone in the company, but the right hands, so that in the event that something does come to us, we're not caught flat-footed.
Right. Like if Brian Krebs comes to you, what are you going to say instead of trying to answering all these questions like Target tried to do without having those answers? Going back with this holding statement, that's sometimes two sentences. I mean, Michaels had a holding statement on their website for 3 months that said, yeah, we have an incident, we're investigating. These are the things that you should do in the meantime. Once we find more details, we'll let you know. Staples did the same thing. That's the way you really need to approach this. And usually the holding statement is just a couple of sentences and basically acknowledging that we are investigating an incident and we have no other, we don't have any information to share right now.
Awesome, so 22 days after. All right, Eric's team have analyzed over 90% of systems for all known indicators of compromise. At this point, the total number of compromise is 32 systems. All right, so Mandy, or Eric's team rather, drafts up a remediation report and an incident report. You know, they hand it over to CISO and legal for review and finalization of it. We'll start with Rob. You know, Rob, what do you do with this report?
I assume this is 90% of a report?
Well,
that's what they're handing me.
Yeah, there's that aspect. You know, Eric, maybe you can expound on that. You know, you get this question a lot when we submit our reports, where Eric quotes 90% of all systems have been analyzed. How are we done?
Yeah. So in this case, if somebody could give let me analyze 100% of their systems, I would be happy. I've never gotten to that state. I'd say 90% is pretty good on average. I think our average is about 80-85% across the board is what we usually get data back from, and the rest nobody can find, or it's just it becomes a shell game.
But you should be asked that question, right? Mm-hmm. Because we have mm-hmm. clients that you want to get visibility into 98% yeah. of their network. So you have to say, are you comfortable with having visibility into 88%? Because there may be good reasons why you're comfortable with that, but that question needs to be asked.
Exactly, and I think it's more than just the endpoint as well. It's the network coverage. So if I have very good network coverage and I don't have 100% endpoint coverage, then I feel more at ease if I'm not seeing any additional malicious traffic, if we've caught all of that. So that's a good point. If I don't have any network coverage, then I'm probably less apt to stop here.
So you know, I'd say 90% doesn't sound acceptable to me. I don't know about the rest of you guys in this room. That doesn't sound acceptable to me. And when you said we've got 32 systems found in the first 90%, that sounds like there's three systems out there that we haven't found yet, right? Something like that. So the only way that 90% is okay with me is if we can come up with some mitigating controls to tell us, all right, we know this malware, right? We've only found one piece of malware in the first 90% of the organization, and we found it 32 times. If it does exist on that last 10%, how do we reduce the risk of that? How do we, you know, if it's out there on that system we couldn't scan and it tries to connect, will we know it? Can we stop it from having an impact? You know, we have to come up with something beyond just saying, sorry, that last 10% was too hard. That's not a good enough answer.
I like you.
I think Eric was definitely alluding to those mitigation controls for the last 10%, you know, being that network coverage. You know, your example of, you know, we have that one piece of malware, we know the command and control, we see the five systems beaconing to it. You know, the final 10%, you know, if there's a beacon out of those 10%, we're hoping the network coverage would cover it. You know, let's pretend we have the best networking coverage in the world. You know, and if it doesn't catch it, you know, we prove that to you, would you be comfortable then accepting a 90% report?
Yeah, so what we want to do is explain to me what the malware does, which of course would have happened by now, right?
Mm-hmm.
And here's what the malware does, and here's how we would know if it existed on one of those systems and wakes up later. I think we can get some comfort at that point if we do that. Yeah.
Perfect. So let's say you're comfortable with that level. You know, the report, you know, as a CISO, do you distribute or not distribute?
So I haven't seen the report, so I don't know. The high points of the report need to be shared, especially the ugly parts, right? And it's a little easier being the new CISO there that it's it's you're reporting on somebody else's mistake. It's harder if you've been there for years and you're now reporting on your mistake. But nonetheless, you know, full disclosure, vulnerability with your leadership team, I think, is the way to go there. Talk about the ugly parts. We're not going to get into everything in a report like that. But what are the key points? What is the action items that should be taken as a result of that? I don't, you know, they're going to want to know the story. You know, these are the bad guys. This is why bad guys came after us. Here's what we did, and we'll tell that. But there's, I think, most of the conversation should be about and so what and so what, right? Because of this, we should do these things in the future, and we should get better in this way. And how do we improve our processes? The lessons learned aspect is what I'm most excited about out of the report.
I will tell you, if I'm involved in this investigation, you are not issuing a report on day 22.
I was waiting for you to say that.
There is no way in hell that is coming out yet. And there's a reason for that, because we want to go through an investigation, we want to figure out what happened. Then we need to think strategically what's going to happen at after the incident response. Are regulators going to be coming in and doing an investigation? Are we presented with class action litigation? Do I need a remediation report that's going to be separate from the incident response report? Do I want the incident response report to be covered by attorney work product and not privilege, because I know I'm going to end up turning it over to a regulator or over in discovery in a class action lawsuit, and I can still maintain protections if I do it that way. So there, then, before I even see a report from you, we're doing a WebEx to make sure you're addressing the issues that I need you to address in this report. It's not about changing the report and making it more favorable. It's making sure we hit the points that we need to without drafts floating around unnecessarily. So there's a lot of thought that needs to go into the reports before they're issued.
Yep, and I did learn my lesson the hard way. I will never issue a report without going through external counsel on that.
Right. Yep. You would never work for me again if you did.
Absolutely not.
Nope. Yeah, I'm serious. It really can present so much liability for a client when a forensics provider comes back with a report before you've had the opportunity to tell them, this is what I need to address. It's not what you think it's important. It's what other external parties are going to need to see in that report.
And these are the folks that's why we lean on. You know what their best interests are with regard to the law and how we do things, and that's why everything needs to funnel through.
Even for a remediation report, it's not that you're trying to take things out and change what the company needs to do, but there may be an operational issue that you may not be able to deploy a certain protection that they think you need to deploy, and we need to make that tier 3 or tier 4 because of those reasons, and there's opportunities for you to change the timing of those. And appropriately.
Yep.
There are a couple of questions. Lady in there, back there.
In this process, where do you start interacting with your insurance carrier if you've got cyber insurance?
Ooh, the question was, do you start interacting with your cyber insurance carrier? Ted?
Yeah, so you should be putting your broker on notice. And I'd say work through your broker. As soon as you're talking about bringing in external parties. So before you do that, it's early on as possible. My experience is, this is not like car insurance, where every time you get a ding, the insurance guy goes, hey, it's 50 more bucks for us. This is really about, they look at a risk and they say, I have not received a report of a breach from them in the 3 years we've insured them. They either do not know what the heck they're doing and are not reporting things to us and are a bad risk, or they're really, really good. They're better than anyone else. So they like to see these reports because it helps them manage the risk and it helps them understand what you're being presented with so that they can help protect you moving forward. It really does make you a better risk. Well, that's an easy question. As soon as possible, you should get outside counsel involved. But really, you should be, if you're convening the incident response team, you should be contacting outside counsel. And if you're working with good, reliable outside counsel, we're not going to jump in, because we're busy. We have a lot of things going on, and we don't have to say, okay, now it's the time. Let's start billing and making a lot of money. It may be you need to get these questions answered, and then let's figure out if we need to get involved further. But once you're starting to contact people, I mean, people come to us first, and then we'll tell them sometimes, you need to contact your carrier, because there's going to be some issues with vendors here, or we don't want an untimeliness issue that you didn't report it timely. So we try to involve them very, very quickly. And privilege can be maintained with the carrier. So, you know, there's certain things you can share with them without waiving privilege.
You should, as you're picking your third-party incident response and forensics teams, you should have your broker involved with that, get a list of pre-approved folks or whatever, and that should have all been done months before, right? Years before.
And you know, they have a lot of, they see a lot. I mean, you take a look at a carrier like Beazley, who handles thousands of claims every year, and you may say, we're using, you know, my brother-in-law's forensics company, and they say, you know what? We've handled 30 of these, and this is the forensics provider we're working with, and they're gonna get to the answer very quickly. So, you know, it's good to involve them because they do have a lot of insight.
And like I said, that one of the first questions I ask is, do you have external counsel involved? Second question is, do you have a cyber insurance carrier? Because we do have special partnerships and SOWs and rates and such, like with Beazley, where we ask that so we can get everything set up right in the beginning.
Awesome. So, loaded question for the panel. Do you even want a report?
I do. I, but this is why it's important to have legal involved with security as well, because we have different perspectives, right? I'm not here to cover my butt. I'm here to make things better, and I need a lawyer there to help us cover our butt at the same time. I want the report. I want the data.
I'd say 95% of the time, we want a report. And we wanted to, and the reason we want a report is because there's certain things that we need to do moving forward, and unless it's in writing, it's never going to get accomplished. So you sort of have to support people on the team. So we rely on a client, and we'll say, what are you going to do with this report? How are you going to use it? What purpose is it going to be used for? And then we can develop the report that way. If you are having a regulatory investigation, you are going to need a report. They're going to ask for it. And if you don't have one, they're going to force you to do it, or they're going to end up issuing a subpoena for a mandate to come in and tell them everything that they found. And it becomes very hostile. So there's ways you can get regulators off your back by having the report. So I think in most cases, you're going to want to see something.
Yeah, we didn't really get into remediation here. And I think it's just a focus on the process rather than technical is why we haven't done that. But
and coming up in the next slide. So quick debrief, then we'll hit remediation, I promise. All right, so Eric, question in the back.
Every industry is regulated probably in some way. So if you're talking about consumer information, you're going to have state AGs, state attorney generals, who are going to be interested in enforcing their consumer fraud statutes and investigating their power, using their investigatory powers under their data breach notification statutes in some cases. AGs are also going to have power under HIPAA to enforce compliance with HIPAA. If you're in healthcare, you have to deal with the OCR, Office for Civil Rights, and you have to deal with state AGs. If you're involved in consumer data and you're talking about cross-border issues, even within the United States, across interstate commerce, the Federal Trade Commission is going to be watching you. If you're a public company, the SEC is going to be watching you and looking for what you're providing in your 10K, what your cyber risk factors are. So no matter where you turn, there is a regulator that is looking at you, and here's the bottom line. They're all reading from the same playbook. No one is creating something new. They're following what HHS is doing with OCR after healthcare investigation, and they're seeing all the data that they've collected, and they're asking the same questions no matter what industry you're in. I think they're tied together, but I think culture of compliance goes beyond just checking the boxes and we're doing this. It's about how the organization is dealing with this issue on an enterprise basis, how we're confronting these issues. I think that when regulators come in, they do take a look at how the organization is addressing risks. Where I think companies fall down when we talk about compliance issues and a culture of compliance, it's not elimination of risk. We need to get over that. This is about mitigating our risk to an acceptable level. We're never going to eliminate our risk. So I think if you're focused on that when you're dealing with compliance issues, then you're going in the wrong direction. But if you recognize that this is really about just mitigating risk, that you can still have a solid culture of compliance.
Paul, I think your question is really, or your comment maybe, is really relevant, that the compliance versus security, and compliance being my way of thinking of it, compliance is, what's the least I can do to make that box get checked? Whereas security is, what's the most I can do with the resources I have available to reduce the risk? And I get where you're coming from in terms of, you know, you're managing risk in it from a different perspective, but from a security practitioner's perspective, compliance is, hey, gosh, we got to do that thing. Well, let's get them off our back by, you know, installing the agent but not turning on any filtering, right? Whereas security is, let's use these tools as best we can to reduce the risk, to, you know, assure the CIA triad.
But I think it's the same. I think we absolutely agree, because it's not getting the best security; it's getting the best security to put the risk level to an acceptable level, right? And mitigating it to that level. It's not eliminating that risk. Because when you talk about security awareness, people are gonna ask IS or IT to deploy all sorts of tools that are gonna hurt you operationally, and you're not gonna be able to function. And yeah, it may protect your organization more, but you're gonna have other issues. So I think security awareness, you can't lose sight that It's not about getting the ultimately best security that's going to be outdated tomorrow. It's about making sure you understand what your risks are and bringing them down to an acceptable level.
I really just think, Paul, it really goes to the question of why are we doing this, and at what level of buy-in do we get? If at the highest level it's, hey, just do the thing the security guys do, get them off your back, if that's what the executives are saying, then that's what you're going to get at every level below them as well. And we need to talk about why this is important to our business. It's an easy sell at Ping where I am. But your organization, how is security a positive thing? You know, compliance is easy, but security is a harder case to make. And how do you make that as an important case? I don't mean compliance is easy to do. I mean it's an easy case to make, because if you don't do it, the fines are there and right. You can't do business. Security is not quite as easy a case to make for the importance of it. Figure out how to do that in your organization. And I think you have to do both.
Awesome. So speaking of remediation, all right, so day 30, right? So Eric, actually this slide is more for you. Can you, let's go off the slide here and just describe what a typical remediation event, what it entails, the level of effort, you know, what typically happens during remediation effort.
Sure, yep. So, and at this point, we've likely done some containment to stop the bleeding. However, given that the attackers, we know they have let's assume they have all the passwords, so they've compromised the domain. They have back doors out there, and we're at 90%, so, you know, we may have a back door out there. We don't know. So with this, one of the things I would recommend is what I call remediation weekend. A lot of times, as you said, a lot of companies cannot disconnect from the internet, but what they can do is limit what is coming in and what is going out, so whitelisting certain things while we do the remediation. In addition, the whole time we've been under the investigation, we should have been in a posturing state in which we're going through and we're cataloging what are the groups memberships look like, basically planning out how we're going to do remediation, because I can tell you it can take 30 days, sometimes 60 days, just to do that. But because during the remediation weekend, we're likely changing all the passwords, we may even be recycling some of the internal Kerberos passwords and such. We're likely deploying, hopefully, two-factor at this point, because I doubt they have two-factor given all this information. So there's a lot of pieces in changing up firewall rules and just making sure. The point is making sure the attacker is kicked out for good. I mean, they're going to try to come back. So you've got to do as much as you can to make sure you got them out, and then watch to see if they do get back in.
And don't inflame them. I mean, that's the thing that we see happen a lot. Everyone's like, it's the Chinese. We got to put it in our press release that it's the Chinese. The Chinese don't really like when you do that, and they come back to you pretty aggressively, and it is very distracting. So, you know, that's fine. We can talk about it internally, but we do not need to make this the subject of our press release. And in fact, there are many times you'll even chime in with the client and say, you really don't want to do that.
And don't toy with them during the process either.
Right.
I had one piece where the client's like, well, I'll just change the that from a gigabit connection to a 10 meg. Then all that did was piss off the attacker. So they just they compromised 10 other machines and started. it was awful.
These people are smart.
Yeah.
Awesome. So, quick summary of our incident here. So, we identified an initial point of compromise. Hopefully, at this point, you know, we have attribution. Our friends at the FBI can provide us a little bit of that. We've effectively scoped the incident out, and we covered 90% of the enterprise. You know, so data theft. What do we know? You know, we know for sure the 700 meg email archive, because it came from an external source. You know, short of the FBI fabricating data, pretty positive, you know, that data was stolen at some point or another from our network. You know, there's that that potential W-2 archive, you know, and then the username and password hashes that were also found. All right, so let's say we've successfully gone through the remediation event. I like to call it an event. Eric likes to call it a weekend. You know, and at this point, you know, we were very fortunate enough to control media and stakeholder speculation. you know, like Rob had mentioned, that holding statement, you know, kind of keeping everything a little bit closer than instead of just blasting an email out to all the employees. That's very prevalent, you know, in a world where we want to know things as soon as possible. You know, some companies cater to that, where I had a client, you know, as soon as we showed up, you know, Jerry, I want to address the company right now with you standing right next to me. I'm like, no. Right, let's get legal involved first before, you know, you do something like that. You know, it's one of those things where as soon as one person knows, the Twitterverse is going to know. I think we kind of hammered home on that pretty good for the incident here. You know, at this point, before we go into our key point and wrapping up, any questions on the scenario?
It is that email. That email compromise is what scares me the most. And we have to have gone through those emails at some point. And we have to, you know, have people we trust look documenting what is interesting in those emails that might get out. And then we deal with those one at a time.
Right. We'll do search queries against the emails to see if we can get key terms and see if we start getting hits. We'll figure out how long you've had those emails in place and what kind of activities they have. You know, we come across PDF files that are not searchable, and we literally hire crews of temporary attorneys who go through them one by one and record the information into a spreadsheet so that we can build our notification list. So we didn't really cover a lot of this stuff, but there's a lot that's going on, making sure, not that it's that we leave no stone unturned, but that we truly understand the scope of this incident so that we go out, we're not gonna have to make a second announcement correcting what we've already told people.
So he's thinking about notifications, and I'm thinking about Sony USA and the, you know, the DNC email hack and these places where the things that come out, it's not so much notifications that I'm worried about, it's what's this gonna do to my business, right? And understanding how do you start to put defensive things in place against that news? And that's what I'm most concerned about. And you do, and I have in my career, looked through every single email in mailboxes before to figure that stuff out. And that's just something you have to do, and it's dirty work that takes a long time.
If I know that the 700 megs is your files, I'm going to give that back to you, so that you can figure out what the value of that is. If I know who the actor is or what type of actor it is, I may be able to provide some value to you for that. But yeah, you're going to get that information back so that you can do that analysis. No.
You're shaking your head. No.
If it's there, it's there.
Most likely you're not gonna know our source on where we got that.
There was one thing in the remediation that we glossed over that I just wanna point out. We say enterprise-wide password reset. If you tell your IT team to do this, they'll say, no problem, we'll have it done tomorrow. And what that will mean is that they didn't really do it. So
yeah, right.
There, how many systems do you have that don't require password changes, service accounts? You know, there's a lot of accounts that are very, very difficult to change the password on. And those accounts need to be changed too in this situation. That the password dump probably included those. So just be ready. You know, if you guys haven't done a change of all passwords recently, you should do it because it's hard. That's why you should do it. And get good at doing that, because it's a painful
point.
Thing.
Yeah,
that's a great point. Doing it outside of a crisis.
Yep. and that's why the posturing starts day one as well, because it does take that long to plan for something like this.
And then look at that. Key points, right? Preparing for an IR. Things such as having a plan, you know, effective visibility, having the log data. I think we hammered home a lot of these points during the scenario. So I'm going to kind of fly through these here really quickly. You know, one of the things that a lot of us here highlighted, definitely I want to highlight this one, is retainers. Retainers for everything. There are so many services out there that will offer a $0 retainer just to get paperwork out of the way. Be a legal firm, you know, a forensics firm, a PR firm. Figure out what you need in your business and start getting those that paperwork out of the way. I think somebody mentioned it. I think it was Ted that, you know, yeah, sure. Eric and company, they would love to get on the ground running, you know, at hour number one, but we can't. You know, your legal team has to review MSAs, statements of work or whatnot. And believe it or not, yeah, sometimes it takes 2 weeks.
Sometimes four.
I'm being optimistic. All right, and, you know, declaring an incident, you kind of went through that with, like, you know, CISO, you know, what do you do? You know, when do we declare an incident? You know, when to notify executive management? You know, and then, you know, that threshold of when to, you know, when to gather the IR team. All right, and then managing the response, the communications. You know, big one there, you know, who do we communicate with and how? You know, what types of communications do we have? You know, when do we call the FBI? If the FBI didn't call us in this situation, you know, do we even call them at this point? You know, is there any information that, you know, would lead us to call the FBI? You know, executing the response, you know, technical capabilities, you know, Rob and Eric, I think you guys did a good job of hammering home, you know, the types of tech. You know, the big question with technical capabilities is, why is it taking so long? Or, hey, it's been 2 weeks. Why only 25%? You know, understand your technology, understand the capability of it. You know, do dry runs of things, you know, hold tabletop exercise for your internal teams. I know it's preaching to the choir and stuff when it comes to those kinds of things, but, and then, of course, you know, who has the time?
But, and I want to be clear, who needs to be at the tabletop? All of the people who would be in a real incident. Mm-hmm. It's not just your security team, right? Not just security and IT. You need to go get the business leaders there as well. And you might think they're going to hate it, but they kind of like it. They think it's kind of fun. You know, it's not real work for them. They kind of get to play around and pretend for a little bit. It's fine. Tell them to come do it. They'll have a good time. Bring pizza. It's something you need to do frequently.
Yeah, absolutely.
At least once a year.
You know, then more technical items here. You know, that IP address we talked about. You know, right now, if you show of hands, you know, who knows what capability you have in house right now to block an IP address? Or moving forward. Thank you. well, thank you for coming. I'll leave this slide up. If anybody has any questions or want to figure out a way to contact us, there's our information. Any questions before we wrap up? There is a happy hour that's starting right now, and then please grab bags as you're leaving. Questions, sir?
Yeah, there are some resources out there, and I don't have them on the top of my head right now, but just some general rules of thumb. For example, for firewall logs, one of the things we always see is our clients are logging denies, but not logging success. Whereas success is what we really want to see, because we don't care about the denies because they didn't get in. And the same thing with authentication. One piece I really love is if a client has what's called SysMon on servers, where it's recording process execution. Because that and you can really kill a system with that if you set it up the wrong way, but that gives a wealth of information on the processes that executed, the hash of the file that executed, so you can actually get some insight. Even if the files are gone, you can actually know what it was. So little things like that, I'd say, just in database logging as well. That's a really fine line, because you can really kill a database system too by logging too much. But start with those logging those successes and authentications, and seeing how you can broaden from there. You guys have any? Are you gonna call me crazy? No.
Good.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, all panelists.